And I want to get us going here, introduce to you Fritz Maurer and his wife Gretchen. And
good.
My wife Gretchen and where's Daniel? How many know Daniel?
A few
people. So, but I'm a counselor and my office is in the Congregational Church of Eastford. And I'm also a coach, transformational coach. So some of you may have been interacted with me on the counseling setting. I'll be in a different mode this morning. I'm more in a coaching mode. And so I'm going to be encouraging you. One of the things that really is passionate in my heart is helping families and individuals make some progress in their life. And whether it's counseling, which is working on the current issues in life, or therapy, which is working on trauma and things of the past, or coaching is like, here's where I stand, and that's where I want to go. And so I get excited about helping people do that. My wife also is a coach, and she's the one who's been like kicking me along in the years. And I don't think I would have gone to school if it wasn't her encouraging me. So, so maybe just a little bit about me, and then Gretchen will say a little bit about her, and then we can introduce Daniel. So I grew up in a family of six kids. So I know there's families around here that have a lot of kids. Like, are any of the Hagstroms here? No. Like, there's a lot of them, right? So this illustration was drawn by, some of you know Joshua. So when you see Joshua, please encourage him. And okay, he's a great artist, and I think he can make a living at this. And so, well, we got some of his drawings here. I have some in other places, and so it's exciting to see that. So family of six. Grew up, my father had a family business that was started by my grandfather. He was a German immigrant, came here in 1927, and worked in the aerospace industry during the war, and started his own business after the war. So, grew up in that business, and then going to Grace Baptist Church in Milford, Connecticut, and served in a number of variety. I did everything from ushering to deacon to eventually being an elder in that church. And there were these two paths, kind of parallel paths going. Our church life, raising the kids. We have two daughters, and the oldest one, you'll tell about the kids, sorry. So, and these two paths began to converge. And as we were serving in our church, in the youth group, my wife loves junior high kids, God bless her. Anybody like junior high kids? Some people do.
Yes.
I like the college.
Puppies.
I like the college age. So, and God just began to put on our hearts to do something more and to serve Him. And so I actually went back to school at age 36, finished my undergrad in industrial organizational psychology at Albertus Magnus College in New Haven, Connecticut. And then I went on and did my master's in counseling at Nyack College, Alliance Theological Seminary, Nyack, New York. So that was a 7-year process of getting through.
And it was great. I didn't have to entertain for 7 years.
Because Fritz always was either doing homework or at school or at work. So
I almost forgot how.
Yeah, we know what chaos is. We know what chaos is. And then working through that. Yet we also learned some things along the way on how to manage it. We'll share that today. And so that was the process. I eventually finished up at seminary and then went up to His Mansion Ministries, which I believe this church supports. And so His Mansion Ministries up in, where in New Hampshire?
Doesn't matter.
It's in New Hampshire. Hillsboro. And we were up there for 6.5 years as director of counseling. Stan Farmer took a chance on me because of the admin business experience that I had. That was easy. What was hard was learning after I had all this theory in my head, how do I apply it in helping people that have been either severely addicted or traumatized in some way. So we worked with both men and women in a 1-year program up there, again 6.5 years as director of counseling. Gretchen worked with women in the trauma class and also mentoring some of the staff women on the Hill.
So they gave me all the guys with ADD.
Yeah, for working out of the farm.
I like that.
Yeah. So then I served and worked at a secular organization in Manchester, New Hampshire, dual diagnosis, and what that means is severe and persistent mental illness along with addiction, and I was a lead clinician in a residential program there. That was tremendous. All of that just was this ramp up of experience that God provided for me for counseling. And so we got back into this area. We were working with His Oaks Ministry, which is in Eastford. It's a recovery home for men in transition. And we were there for 18 months, living in the home with the guys, which was an experience. And now we're in private practice here in this area. Our desire is to quickly, this would introduce some of the others. If you could think of a spoke on a wheel, and this is a home base for us, which is in Chaplin. We have an agreement with the Congregational Church of Eastford, where my main office is for meeting people. We have an agreement with Green Valley Crossing in Putnam, where Daniel is meeting with people. And we're working on agreement with a church in Willimantic, and also working on agreement with a church down in Griswold. The desire is to have a counseling presence in the northeast corner of Connecticut that's soundly professional, but devoted to Christianity. And so we are seeking to just fill those offices with people like Daniel, who just finished up at Liberty. And I want to say a little bit about, come on up here and say a little bit about where you're at in your process, and then Gretchen will get on with what she's going to do.
Well, for those who don't know me, I'm Daniel. My wife and I both attend here, and we live in Putnam with our son, Justice. As Fritz said, I just recently graduated from Liberty University with my master's in professional counseling. And so I'm currently working on getting all of my licensure hours under my belt so that I can kind of go a little bit more, more almost full time into the private practice stuff. But in the meantime, I am working at a local agency in Putnam, CHR, across from Day Kimball Hospital. It's interesting how God is, I kind of have the same almost path that Fritz just described for himself, as far as going back to school a little bit later in life. Right now I'm in a facility that focuses on dual diagnosis, people who are coming out of addiction into recovery, but also with mental health issues. And so I'm excited about, you know, about this spoke, about this wheel, you know, and about what God is doing in this area. And so anyway, as he said, I'm available over at the Green Valley Crossing location, and he's available out in Eastford. And so we just, it was good to meet you, and yeah. Just glad to be here this morning. Yeah. So
I
want to
just jump on a little thing. Piggyback on what Leon has said about having all these plans, and I'm a real planner because I'm a visionary and an entrepreneur by spirit, so I'm always way out there and planning and dreaming and
Gretchen and Fritz is always like, hold up. So.
And in my mind, back when we had gotten married, we got married at 19, so we've been married 37 years. I was like, okay, we're gonna have two kids, right, Fritz? Right?
Yes.
Doesn't matter what sex, right? Two kids.
Two kids.
So we had two kids. We had two girls. That was it. And okay, so they're gonna do Christian school, you know, through regular.
We had it
years.
All planned out.
Yeah.
Yes.
And then public high school, so they can just kind of, you know, get a little taste of bouncing around. And then Christian college, and. And we're going to do that whole virginity ceremony, and, you know, we bought our daughter this necklace with a little key to your virginity, and just, it was all planned. It sounded great.
Yeah. Curious
so,
to interrupt the plan.
Well,
yeah.
Don't blow the punchline.
All right.
So, finally got our daughter into preschool, which was either she went to preschool at 3 or I would be in. Put in a sane asylum. And about a week into preschool, the teacher's like, Mrs. Maurer, can you come into my office? I'm like, they found out. She was in trouble already in preschool, and I didn't know what to do. I just started bawling in her office, like, yes, I know, tell me what to do, I have no idea. And then we did get her into Christian Heritage in Trumbull, because we were living in Milford at the time, and Mrs. Maurer, can you come into the office and meet with the principal? And there's my little kindergartner in trouble. Mm-hmm. And by first grade, they're like, she can't really come to school here anymore.
My daughter got kicked out of first grade.
Yeah, she got kicked out of first grade. And so to say all this is, we don't have it and didn't have it mastered. There's no master, okay? Now, and our second daughter, she probably got student of the month every week. And the other poor child never. Well, I know what she got every week. That was detention. So every Saturday it was driving my daughter to detention. You might drive your daughter to dance, but you know, ours went to detention. And so we lived with these two girls, and the younger one didn't want anyone to know that was her sister. So her whole life was, I don't want anyone to know this is my sister, so if my sister pierces her ears, I'm not going to pierce my ears. My sister gets a tattoo, I'm not going to get a tattoo. My sister has 1,000 boyfriends, I'm not going to have any boyfriends. And so even though the younger child was a good student, an A student, went to college, graduated, she just bought a house in West Haven with ocean views all by herself at age 30, she lost who she was. She didn't know who she was. And so it's just been an interesting journey.
Yep.
And the older one, let's see, got pregnant, got arrested, went to rehab. So we've been there.
Yeah, if it was only the youngest daughter that we had, we would have
loved. Well, if we had the youngest daughter first, yeah. We would have been just like, no, God was so good to us.
Yeah, yeah.
We wouldn't be the Christians. We wouldn't have the prayer life. I remember, we moved from one big house, we downsized, and this house had stairs, and then stairs, and three bedrooms, so two upstairs, and then my daughter, probably was not a good idea to give her the downstairs bedroom, with windows to the ground level, you know. And I spent some nights sleeping on that little landing, just waiting to hear if she went out, you know. But it didn't matter, we heard stories years later that she stole the car and drove it in first gear to the mall. The whole way.
Yeah.
Ran and over the bushes. I mean, we've been there, and
we've been down the road.
We've been to complete desperation, and I forgot. She ran away with a drug dealer when she was 17. We haven't went through that too. And I have permission from my girls right now to tell all these stories because my 32-year-old is. She had gone to his mansion, and that's how. She's like, Mom and Dad, you gotta come up here. They don't know a thing about ADD or anything like that. And she was born with some birth trauma, and she has 126 IQ, but that doesn't do anything to decisions. Mm-hmm. You know, they're great adults. And I would tell her, honey, get through school. And actually, by senior year, I knew she wasn't gonna make it. I said, Kirsten, just quit. Quit and get a job, because you don't have enough credits. Let's figure this out differently. And really, that just made us learn how to embrace our kids where they were. I really learned how to love unconditionally. we have our own issues. I started therapy in my late 20s because there was some trauma in my past. But as a 30-year-old and 32-year-old, parents about age 25, 26, the frontal lobe finally matures.
Yeah.
And when that frontal lobe matures, decision making gets better.
Yeah.
And we have fabulous relationship with our two girls right now.
God's done a wonderful work of restoring those relationships.
So we're not up here because we did it right. We're up here because we studied and learned by trial. So.
Yeah. There's a lot of pain in the world, isn't there? And I certainly have been on the phone and have worked with parents who have lost children to drug addiction and other issues. And that is one of the most difficult phone calls I've ever had to have. Two mothers I can think of, and a father in particular. And those are very sad.
That's the ones you remember.
So what I'm excited about is to really help parents and help people to put some tools in place that are gonna, there's no guarantee in life, but there's certainly ways which you can mitigate the challenges that are about to come in the teen years and beyond, and especially in our culture today, right? That the tools that we're going to present this morning are tools that have been studied and researched and use, and I use these with clients all the time. We use them in our life. The challenges that we faced with our daughter in the high school years, we started to implement some of these tools, which helped us tremendously, although she was already on a difficult path. So as we're going through it, we will be just like plowing through the material. And it's going to be like you're opening your mouth. You ever had tried to drink water, just gulping it down? It's going to feel like that. I understand that. So hang on. At the end, we'll talk about other possibilities and what we're going to be doing, especially with this material. Opportunities for you if you want to dig in a little bit deeper and have support in that. We'll talk to you at the end today about how we're going to do that for you. Okay? So one of the things that as you go into your handout on page one there, you flip onto page one, you have a couple of verses. And the verse is, I call heaven and earth to witness against you today. I place before you life and death, blessing and curse. Choose life so that you and your children will live. One of the things that is so important for us to understand is that we can make choices in our life and we can change. Now, how many of you know that sounds easy, but it's hard to do. Change can be hard. It is possible, so we'll see that as we move along this morning. And so the idea here is when you're thinking about teenagers, how many, there's a few that had teenagers, and you can think about it. Somebody, a counselor said this to me when I had my teens. He said, look, you've only got 3 or 4 summers with those kids. When you think of it that way, right, just shortened up the time frame. And so what are you going to do in those 3 or 4 summers, or those 3 or 4 years in which are some of the prime years for preparing them for life, right? And so choosing life and death. So we'll talk again about some of those principles moving forward. Proverbs 9:1, wisdom has built her house. She has hewn her 7 pillars. And that's a great verse to be studied. So some of these, we use scripture. We understand that scripture guides us in ways of living and thinking. This material, if you can think about it, is wisdom from other sources. Just as we have wisdom from the medical community or mechanical and engineering, the Bible is our guide for life, yet it is not a complete book in that it doesn't tell you how to do a surgery on your brain or something, or open heart surgery. So again, these principles and we're doing here are things that have been used by others and by me in my office. So what I'm asking for today is that you would have an open mindset. This is one of the most powerful things you could ever learn, is that your way of thinking, you don't have the corner in the world on your way of thinking. How many just say amen to that? You don't have a corner, right? We don't have it exactly all figured out. The only person that has that all figured out is who?
God.
And so, you know, if I brought up some different political items right now, we would have some disagreements. We probably even would have some disagreements maybe on theological issues in the Bible. So what I'm asking is that you would have an open mindset. And just think, you know, what if we were to implement some of these tools? What if our life could be different? And when we do that, that's something that God just provided our brain for. Look, we have a whole lot of cells up here that we're not using all that well. And so some of the open learning is about using some of those brain cells and making new connections. And that's what we're going to be doing, all right? Everybody agree on that?
Yes.
Good. Open mindset. So if you could, Phil, flip to the next screen.
Try it?
Okay. May not work. So we're having the outcomes for today. It's in your handout. So learning some practical tools to reduce chaos and build connection. I'm convinced that what will most mitigate the challenges that you face in your families and with chaos is building relationship. And as Leon has been preaching the past few months, I think, on the dysfunctional families in the Bible, what was it about? It was about relationships that weren't working well, and sin and pain and all that came in. Number 2, to be encouraged, to take charge of your parenting efforts. And this is important to understand, that we're just not being swept away by the waves and the storms of life, and that we stand and take charge of our parenting efforts. How many of you ever felt overwhelmed, too much, can't do it, I'm done, I'm out of here? Yep, I've said it too. I used to have a motorcycle, I sold it because I used to escape on that thing all the time. Ready? Say yes if you're ready, yeah?
Yes.
Yes, all right. So, building connection.
Say hi to people online.
Oh, actually, we're Facebook Live. Hello, Facebook. We're giving this a try. We're trying to get into this new technology here. So, we're going to see how that's going to work. Last time we did this with a camera, we forgot to turn the microphone on. So we had, what was the old days when it was just
silent movie.
Yeah, so I think we're good today. All right, so chaos. In your handouts, you should have gotten this chaos scale. How many of you are now trembling with fear about filling this in? Yes. How chaotic is your family? So researchers at the University of Louisville and Columbia University and other institutions have been studying household chaos actually for a number of years now. And they found, look at your handout, that the number of issues that are a result, right? It's the family chaos and the way things are going in your home have a direct impact on your children. And look at some of the deleterious, I'll use a fancy word, some of the negative impacts. Smaller vocabularies, lower IQ, higher levels of attention, aggression, and conduct problems. Now there is ADHD, no question about it. Our daughter was diagnosed very young with it. However, in some school systems, they have sometimes 30 to 50% of the kids on medication for ADHD. Mm-hmm. That actually doesn't line up with the research as far as the percent population that struggle with it. And so I think some of it is just parenting issues and other problems and chaos at home. Personal opinion there. Delay of gratification, more stress, poor and less consistent sleep patterns, less positive relationship with parents and siblings, and worse overall health. In fact, it's so detrimental to kids that even the best parenting practice can't overcome its effects. Multiple studies have shown that chaos leads to negative outcomes for kids. No matter what your parenting style is, and how much money your family has, or what your kid's personality is like. So it's so important to get the chaos under control. Again, these chaotic homes are characterized by noise and overcrowding and a lack of order, and they tend to score lower on tests of cognitive ability and self-regulation capabilities. And so forth there you can read. Page 2 on your handout. So what is family chaos? It's disorganization, it's a lack of routine, excessive noise, crowdedness, lots of coming and going, overly fast-paced, poor conflict management skills, and confusion. And the confusion is about who's in charge, right? Mom or dad or the kids or some outside influence, the TV or the internet, right? It's common for me to see stressed out, burned out parents struggling to manage their lives and homes and be able to model emotional regulation skills to their children. It's no wonder then as teenagers, they're having difficulty managing life. There is a negative impact on children in your home if there's chaos. And so take a moment and take a look at that chart. And I want you to go down there quickly and fill it in. Which ones stand out for you? So you have, for an example, number one, there is very little commotion in our home. Is that very much like our home, somewhat like our home, a bit like our home, or not at all like our home? So take a moment and do that. Good. Okay, so just think about the chaos scale. Just, again, thinking about the chaos, how is it impacting your family? Just take a moment there and write down, how is chaos impacting your family? Personalize it. How is chaos impacting your family? And if your spouse is here, you can check in with your spouse. See their perception versus yours. And if we're all stressed out and anxious, right? If we're in that fight or flight response, our brain our natural human wiring is to run away from that anxiety and pain. And so how do we do that? We try to maybe control others and how that comes across, or maybe we run away from it. Staying out of that real stress, that's a challenge.
And I think that's really good insight too, because that's exactly how I was too. And I think one of the things, quickly, that Fritz and I, we learned about our personalities is because I'm a project person. I took over the school of things that were projects. Mm-hmm. Fritz is more routine, so he checked in the homework every day. And because our daughter had some special needs, some of the assignments came through the computer, and so he did the day-to-day homework. And so it's good to know how you're wired, mm-hmm. and where you fit, and how much downtime you need for re-energizing. And some people are energized with crowds. I get hyper and excited, but I need a lot of downtime. Mm-hmm. And so there's nothing wrong with how you're wired, and that's also what you need to pay attention to your kids and how they're wired. And when your quiet child who needs to read, they need that time, and the one who needs activity. And so maybe if it's too much for you to run around all over the place, you can find someone to drive them. And so it's just operating in how you are and not trying to be something you're not.
Right. We'll talk about some tools coming up. Yes.
Our house is usually got a lot of frustration,
yeah.
arguments,
mm-hmm.
which leads to anger,
yeah.
and everyone's disrespect.
Yeah, yeah.
It's way out of control.
Right. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And that's the challenge, right? Because the chaos over a long period of time leads to that anger. People are just getting angry at each other. And we'll see later in the day. There's some good tools in here on how to reduce and how to help each other talk in a better way. And so you'll see that, especially in the second half of our time this morning. Yeah, thank you for sharing. It does turn into disrespect, and often there's a underlying cry for something different from each of us. We're spitting and kind of snarling at each other, and it's not going to be for a place of love. Good. One more. Chaos. Yes.
I'm not a very tidy person. I want to be, and I try, but I've noticed a huge, it hugely affects my mental and emotional health.
Mm-hmm.
And then it's this like nasty cycle,
yeah.
because like I'm the homekeeper, and so when I'm stressed out or discouraged, then the messiness gets worse,
mm-hmm.
and then my kids fight more,
yeah.
and then I get more discouraged,
yeah.
and it gets worse, and
yeah.
it's just like,
yeah, it's like
nasty downward spiral.
Yeah, I was gonna say, it's just like this downward spiral.
You and know, then like yeah. a week later, we're like, what just happened this week?
Yeah.
Like, why was it so bad?
You know? And that's a good question. You go back to that, right? And you can maybe think, what we tend to do is we tend to judge ourselves and beat ourselves up and shame ourselves, as opposed to, all right, let's put this down on paper. How did this happen? Well, you know, this, my, you know, health was this, and
yeah,
and a little grace.
That's good. Yeah, good. So you can see chaos is a part of the family struggle. So again, taking that chaos again, it's about thinking about ways in which you can reduce that chaos in your home.
I'm smiling because okay. I have so many stories I could just talk
about. Yeah, I know. Page 3 on your handout. Here we go. Overcoming the chaos. How do we overcome it? I'm a big believer, because I do coaching, I'm a big believer in vision. And I've learned that over the years. I mean, when our kids were young, we were tending just to kind of, each day, I knew I had to get up and go to work, and it was busy at work. Especially when I was younger, I pounded as much overtime as I could get, so I could, in hindsight, just spend more money, yeah, is what I did with it. But anyways, that's another sin issue that I've had to overcome. But the idea is I was just kind of doing life. And as we got further along, when I really decided we were thinking about going back to school, when I got a vision for what God was calling me to, that really propelled me into taking action, and my wife coming along and being on the same page with that vision was a huge part of our move forward. And I've seen over time in working with people how important vision is. Proverbs 29:18 says, where there is no vision, the people become unrestrained. So think about it, chaos is an unrestrained family. And so the idea here is to understand that vision is brings purpose and clarity. It's having a picture in your mind of what you want for your future. And so to picture your family in that place of having less chaos or having more connection will help you pull forward. There's something about vision that disciplines us to move in life in a different direction. And as we're thinking this morning, you know, how many of here ever piloted a small boat or any boaters here, right? If you're on the water and just turn that rudder a little bit, that boat eventually starts to go in a different direction. Here's the thing to encourage you. Just taking some of these tools this morning is like just turning the rudder on your boat just a little bit and you'll go in a different direction. So again, vision is the thing that we want to look out, right? And so when you're doing a boat or farmers here, the old time farmers that were plowing their fields, you don't look down at what's right in front of you, you look out at where you want to go. And that's what vision does again. You're looking to where you want to go in your life. So what is the vision for your family? And again, you can think about this and won't have time to plow into it here as far as developing the whole thing, but I strongly encourage you to think about what the vision is for your family and to have a conversation with your husband or your wife and what do we want? What do we want in our life? And if you're, I know there's some people here just getting married or just thinking about it. And so singles here, you know, what do you want for your future together? So think about that for a moment. I just would like you to answer that question. What do you long for in your family? Write that down right now. Just take a few seconds here. Write that down. What do you long for in your family or in your future? Somebody tell me, what'd you write down for your vision for your future? What do you want? Yes?
Connection, mm-hmm. respect.
Yeah.
Strong, confident kids with good decision making
skills. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Others? Somebody else? Over here? What'd you write down? Go ahead, Rachel. What'd you write? Peace.
Capital letters. Marital unity.
Yeah.
Spiritual strength. Strong relationships.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Be peace.
What's that?
Be peace under those rhythms.
Yeah. So the peace, strong spiritual connection, and what were some others there?
Marital unity.
Marital unity. Yeah. All of those would help to reduce chaos. So here's the other thing that how our brains work. Again, we tend towards fear and anxiety. And there's this way that our brain works. It's called counterintuitive stimulation, if you want the fancy word for it. But it's basically the idea that you ask the question, what if? There hasn't been anything that's been invented, phone, computer, without somebody at first asking, what if I could make this work? What if I, you know, this is really a struggle. What if we could? There's something about our brain that then begins in goal-directed behavior. So when when chaos and anxiety rule, we're not in the part of our brain that's more creative. We're in the kind of the what they call the primitive part of the brain. And so getting it in the prefrontal cortex is where our creativity is. And when we engage in that part of our brain, we can begin to think about ways to change. And then we will begin to think about, okay, what are the smaller steps? So again, understanding that vision helps you pulls you towards your future and it engages your brain in goal-directed behavior. And the next section here is about current reality. Getting clear about what the current reality is and determining what is wanted and needed to support you in moving from chaos to connection is essential. The idea here is that you have your vision, I want something different, and what's going on in my family right now? What's the reality of maybe it's my relationship with my spouse, the relationship with my kids? And here's the thing that I want you to consider, and Phil, you can go to the next slide there. It's this the way it is assessment. And where have you in your life made these assessments or judgments? I have some of them there. This will never be any better. This will never change. My spouse won't work with me on this. We've tried this before. Nothing works. It's too difficult. How many of you think that way sometimes? Mm-hmm. I don't. It's just a natural, what it does though, what it does is it cuts you off from possibility, right? And so I believe our God is a God of resource and possibility. He's provided everything. It says in 1 Peter, it says he's provided everything for a life of love and godliness, right? And so that means that we just haven't seen what we need to do here. Maybe we haven't asked the right person. Maybe we haven't tapped into the right material or book or seminar, something to learning. So current realities, getting clear. So what have you decided about chaos in your life? And what are these assessments? So take a moment there and at the bottom of the page, write down some of those ways in which you think. What assessments have you made about your family life? All right. This will be another way which will just serve you really well in your life, is to challenge the way you're thinking about something. One of the things that I work with, and as counselors we work with, and coaches, is just paying attention to people's thinking. You have this internal committee going on. Every one of us, right? There's always a conversation going on. Sometimes a verbal, but there's always a conversation going on, right? And so oftentimes somebody will be in my office and they're sitting, and I ask them a question, and they're sitting there thinking. And I'll say something like, it'll be helpful if I knew what you were thinking about right now, you know, just to speak that up. And so oftentimes that internal committee is very critical, isn't it? You'll never do it, never measure up, too hard, you're a screw up, you know, all of those kinds of thinking. And that's not helpful. And certainly, it certainly isn't the way that God would want us to think about ourselves. In fact, I often say, you know, if you were to talk to somebody else the way you talk to yourself, you'd probably get in a lot of fights, right? Or you'd be somebody that people wouldn't want to hang around with. Okay, so challenging those judgments. So what you do with them, just kind of a practical way, is when you have those assessments, and then to be able to challenge, what's a new way to think? And this is something you can do when you get home. So whatever that judgment is, somebody share with me one of their assessments. Give me one. Yes?
We're too busy.
Oh, too busy? Another one? What were you thinking?
Efforts haven't worked.
Oh, efforts haven't worked. Okay. Okay. Yeah.
If we just wait it out.
Just wait it out?
It'll get better.
Actually, it's not a bad strategy at times. Yeah, wait it out. Yeah. Now, then it might be all right unless you're ignoring something that really needs to be addressed. You know, and so some people, now again, this is a Fritz thing again, too. I've tended in my life to be conflict avoidant. So I'm just going to wait this one out. I'm not going to talk, you know. Or we'll see later, stonewalling. I'm an expert at stonewalling. You'll understand what that is in a bit. So, all right, too busy, not enough. So how would you challenge that thinking? What would be another way to thinking if you apply this what-if kind of thinking? What would you say to too busy?
Decrease commitments?
Yeah, could be decreased commitments. Yep.
Scheduling.
Yeah. Yeah, we're going to talk about scheduling. Yeah, it could be scheduling, right? There's always another way to think about it. What about efforts have not worked? Yeah. How would you help this person? It's we've tried everything. Now that's kind of all or nothing thinking. So how would you challenge that? What would be a challenge? Let's help this person out. Positive reinforcement, maybe there's another way to do it. I guess the thing that I would think, have I really tapped out everything in all of God's world? Yeah. It's that maybe there's something new. Or maybe there's another person I can talk to. Maybe there's a counselor I can go see. There's some way. So it's like getting out of that, close down, nothing works. Okay, wait it out. Let's help. They're just going to wait it out.
How long?
Yeah. How
was
long?
Like a 20-year waiting?
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. I would want to know what you're waiting for, but wait what out. So yeah, is there other strategies that I can apply? Is this more about me and my conflict avoidant? I'm avoiding having a difficult conversation. Maybe my spouse and I disagree about how Gretchen and I had to work on this. Our counselor back when we were going through stuff in the teen years, he said, look, you guys gotta get on the same page here. Good advice, hard to do. But that was something that we had to work on. Okay, so here we go with some practical tools. Any questions thus far? Okay, got you thinking. The ideal week. You'll see in your, you can flip the page there. It's going to be hard to see on the screen, but I had a sample up there. Now, if you're committed to the way it is, like this has never changed, it's too tough, I don't have enough time, you'll struggle with this. I implore you, I am telling you this works. I use it with clients all the time, I've used it in my own life. When you schedule your life, look, either you schedule life or life will schedule you, right? You've probably seen that happen. And for those of you who are really detailed nerds in here versus more the kind of free-flowing and that, again, Gretchen and I were on opposite ends of that scale, yet I have seen this pay tremendous dividends. And oftentimes clients resist doing this. They come back week after week and they don't do it, and they don't do it. And so that's another issue to talk about in the office about their fears and anxieties or maybe lack of commitment. But again, I'm telling you, the ones who do that find that this works. So, the ideal week is about putting a schedule together. What I've typically done, if I'm doing marital counseling, I have the husband and wife do separate calendars, and then they come together and we talk about it. Because what I often hear is like, people know that we ought to be spending time in quiet time. People know that we ought to be maybe exercising or eating better. People, we kind of know these things, but we don't take action on them. So there's a lack of commitment. And so in your handout there, right before that ideal week, I wanted to hit on this commitment. The ideal week is going to help you hold to the commitments that you make. And one of the things about commitments, you can write this down in that section on commitment. You can either choose to live in regret or choose to live in sacrifice. Your choice. You can choose to live in regret or choose to live in sacrifice. There are things in my family that I didn't do and I regret that I didn't do them. Now, I don't live in the shame and guilt anymore. Done some work in that in my own counseling. And God's done a wonderful work in restoring our family connections. But right now, you can either choose to live in regret or sacrifice. And so making those choices in your schedule, you may need to sacrifice other things to make it happen. But I'm telling you, it'll pay dividends down the road. Okay? So this commitment is so important. In fact, when you study the scriptures, God is a God of commitment. You'll see it over and over again. You can ask your pastor and your teachers in the church here. But you will see it in the Old Testament. God wanted his people to commit to him. And then people were blessed because of the commitment. Now, I don't get into the thing, look, if you commit to God, he's going to bless. I don't want to link those two together in that God is somehow a cosmic gift giver because now I'm doing right. That's not how it works. However, there is the principle of walking in commitment, and when I do it, things come my way. Okay? That makes sense? Fulfillment of a commitment makes for a good life. An action flowing out of commitment really moves you forward in family relationships. Here's another thing. Some of you, if you've seen some of my, we're playing with this Facebook stuff, and I did a little clip on complaining. So you have this internal language you talked about. Here, I'm gonna ask you to think about this. How often do you complain? Yeah? Right? People chuckle. We do it all the time. And Pastor Leon, I'm sure you have business meetings here occasionally. the people get into complaining?
No.
Look, complaining doesn't get us anywhere. Now, it's one thing to state my opinion in a meeting and to have a voice, and that's why we have moderators and stuff. But if we get into complaining, and especially if we're complaining outside of these doors and speaking against one, boy, the enemy, like, look, there's a spiritual reality here. The enemy gets behind that. But the complaining for you is not doing you any good. It's not moving you anywhere. It's keeping you stuck in the way it is. And so I encourage, get complaining, like strike it, like complaining, like get that, you know, that get it, just get it out of your life.
And sometimes if you just say, all right, today, I'm going to pay attention to how much I complain.
Yeah.
And then you don't have to conquer complaining, but start to pay attention to how much you complain or what it is you complain about. And then beneath your complaining is something. There's some need there.
Yeah.
So it's just a small shift in the rubber. Oh, okay. I complain a lot. And then how it makes you feel.
Yeah, I think Gretchen's true there is that underneath every complaint is a longing of some kind. And so get to what the longing is and make a direct request or take action in some way. How many of us use this word should? I should have. Should. Stop shooting on yourself. Doesn't do anything to help you. All it does is feeds the guilt and feeds the shame. So I tell people, whenever you say a should, make a decision. Use it as an action, as a verb. Take action. Maybe you need to forgive. Or maybe, you know, how many of us, oh, I really should have done this, or I should have. Then go do it. Or let go of it and get on with life. So I'm not this direct in regular counseling, but maybe I am sometimes. This is more coaching right now. All right, so get off the shoulds. So complaining. Practical tools, back to the ideal week. Some of the common reactions I hear are take too much time. I don't know how to use a calendar or spreadsheet. There's a big thing right now going on. If you haven't found out about this, right now there's this big organization that's beginning to rule our lives. Google. Up there, that's a Google calendar. I did that. That's like an example of a family week. I made that, and I think it took me about 10 minutes to do that. Now, if I showed you my regular week, it would like fill the page, because I got all kinds of appointments, and Gretchen and I with our different things going on. And I live by my schedule. I have to. Otherwise, I'll forget things. And so it's so important. But when you put it together, it's true. That this tool will support you in getting out of the chaos. And
I'm going to share a little bit about back when my kids, because I'm visual, and not everybody can learn or see or operate the same way. And I bought one of those 3 months at a glance, and I would fill it out and put the kids' things in. And then when the 1 month was done, I'd add in the next month. And that worked for me really well.
Yep.
With the dry erase.
Mm-hmm. Just has anybody used a schedule here, calendar, for family? You find it helpful?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
I have what she has. I have Family Demand Center, and I
have
2 months.
Yes.
Oh, great.
Everything listed on the calendar.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I have a Google calendar that I have synced with my husband's phone too, so we can see what all
The other thing is like...
And it just takes a little time to learn it and to set it up. And what did you say? How many things you can keep in your head at once?
Well, the human brain, you only can keep about 3 to 5 items in your brain that need...
That's why I got something written on my finger here today.
Yeah. So, if you're trying to keep everything in your head, you're going to have brain spillage. So you're going to forget something. And so you need to have that calendar, and it helps. I can't hammer this home enough. So, taking some time, yes, Phil?
Can I share something?
Yeah, go ahead.
Well, a lot of you know me, but we have 2 teens, and my daughter has a cell phone, and if you have young children, you think my kids aren't going to get phones until they're 18 and 19. No, 12 and 13, they're going to be having phones.
Yeah, yeah.
But what we did about a year or two ago is, my daughter just got a phone, and so we linked our calendars all together.
Mm-hmm.
And my son will eventually be getting a phone, I don't know when, as soon as he decide that he wants to buy it.
Mm-hmm.
So,
good move.
So we link all of our phones together so all our calendars are the same.
Mm-hmm.
And so I know my daughter has drama practice at home because I look it on my phone. And just this week, I was at somebody's house. I'm not going to say who it is. They have five children from 16 to 3,
mm-hmm.
3 to 16. And I was showing him, you know, hey, you know, we have this on our phone, so I know exactly what's going on with my daughter. And even my son has it on his tablet thing.
Mm-hmm.
He has it on the phone. And the dad was like, oh, man, I need to do this.
Mm-hmm.
But he never will. You just got to take the time to do it.
You got to take the time to do it.
It's so helpful.
It is.
I'll second what you said.
Yeah, yeah, it does work. Again, the families that use it, and look, the busiest people in the world, the most successful CEOs, business leaders, they go by a calendar, and they've learned to say no, right? They say no more often than they say yes. They live by their calendar, and so this will be, so what you can do, when I say it's the ideal week, you can, when you put down your, when you're talking about it, I'll just do a few days here, but it's like, put the essentials in. If it's, if you were to look at mine, if I were to pull mine up, you would see, I have my wake up every morning at 6:30. Gretchen and I, we actually exercise together in the morning. This has been great. We've been doing we've been doing yoga. Don't judge me on that, but yoga is very, very helpful for deep breathing and stress reduction.
Old bones.
It's actually lowered my, blood pressure. It's really been amazing doing the yoga. So, and then quiet times for me. I have a time where I can sit. Now, we don't have kids anymore, and I've thought about that. But I'd like to redo it, like do a redo with kids again, and then I think, nah, sorry. So, but I do, and I have quiet time.
Figure it out. I mean, it doesn't, I'm not a rigid schedule person, and I don't like to try something I know with my ADD brain, I'm gonna fail because I don't need to pile on more shame to myself. Mm-hmm. So, and I'll have really deep moments with God and then maybe 4 or 5 days with nothing and then time with a quiet time and then a week with quiet time and then, so just go with the flow, just about the heart.
So. Yeah, so this is, and you've probably heard it in church since you're, if you've been in church, do a quiet time. I'm telling you, it works. Why does it work? Anybody have an idea why taking that time for yourself in the morning works? Yeah.
It centers you for the whole day.
It centers you for the day.
Yeah.
Gets your brain unfocused on the positive. There's something more going on in the world than just me and my life, right? It just, our brains again, when we set our, you're setting yourself up for success is what you're doing. So by the time I get, if like Fridays are a busy day for me, I had 6 sessions yesterday. For me, that's a long day. By the time Friday night comes, I go home on the couch and I'm wiped because of emotionally. But I need to set myself up for success for that day. Because I want to hear from God in the sessions. I want to know, God, speak to me about this. What's going on? How can I best help that person? I need to be in tune. It's like tuning my ears and my brain for success here. And so it helps. So when you're working on your ideal week, just put in those things that you know, these are the essentials. Gotta have them, gotta happen. Church on Sunday, maybe kids group on Wednesday nights. Whatever those essentials are, put them in there and then start filling it in.
And it's not all or nothing, and it's not a one-time deal. You can try it, doesn't work. Try another calendar, it doesn't work. But just keep pushing.
And this is where compromise comes in, because if the two people put in their schedules together, well, we gotta see how this is gonna work. And we've gotta talk about that, okay? So in your handouts, I gave you a blank sheet about the week. You can do this. That's right off of an Excel spreadsheet. So you can make copies of it or get on Excel and you can do it on Excel. That's the way I actually did mine first. I did it on Excel first, or by hand. I did Excel, and then I transferred it to my Google calendar. And that's how I did it.
I think I made a calendar and then I stared at it for 2 months and my phone would go off and I'm like, yeah, I see you. Because I'm a little more stubborn.
Yeah.
But eventually, when you, whatever your vision is for your family or your vision is for your career, you know, I'm going to coach people and I've got phone calls to make. I can't miss those things.
Yeah.
So what do you want out of life and then what you need to do to get there?
And also for one of the things I work with couples when I'm working with them, is scheduling in time for each other. And it pays huge dividends. They call them routines of connection. If you come to me for counseling, I talk about routines of connection and love maps and building those in. I always talk about vision for couples, and then we talk about the ways in which their life has kind of drifted apart, and how you bring them back in is intentional time together. So my wife and I have a date night on Friday. We've done that for a long time. And when Fritz has failed to fulfill that promise of spending time with my wife on Friday nights, that's a negative impact. It's a broken promise in our relationship, but it's paid, again, huge dividends for us. So we have our time in the morning. We have check-ins during the day. I always call my wife at lunch. I always call her at supper when I'm off the office, and I check in with her when I come home. When I get home at night, I go find my wife, or she finds me, and we say hello. We greet each other. We take a few minutes just to check in. Get off the cell phone, get off the computer, and check in with your spouse. I'm going to come up with a diagnosis for cell phones and marriages, because it's causing all kinds of problems, and Facebook is causing problems.
I mean, there were years yeah. where he'd go to bed, I'd be up online till midnight, yeah. 1 o'clock, mm-hmm. because it's an avoidance thing, you know, and there's current reality in some of the things that you're doing or not doing, and what's really there, what are you avoiding, or what, you know, what's going on, and
yep.
So then there's maybe just work that's little deeper than just your schedule. That's yeah. for you to figure out.
Yeah. And one thing I tell people, look, if you spend as much time talking to your spouse as you do spending on Facebook or on chat and texting with somebody else, you will greatly improve your relationship. Yes, Lee?
I think both my kids have a thing in their families where they have I think Sunday or Saturday is a screen-free day.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. No, none at all. And so
nice.
I think making a commitment like that.
Yeah. Now that's another commitment.
What do I do with myself?
Yeah,
so I have to talk to
myself. Yeah, and they have to talk to each other. Yeah. So some families I've had families do that. They have no games for a certain amount of time. So it could be for your ideal week. I think I had on that one there, which you can't see too well. Have homework time in there. So those are great. I have one family. What they did is during the week, the kids got to show that their homework is done before they can get on the video games. Now some families choose, look, you can come home and you can spend 30 minutes doing something, then you got to get to the, so whatever works for your family, but you can figure that out. So, and what are the kids going to do when you try to pull the electronics away from them? They are going to fight. And we'll talk more about standing your ground at the end. All right. So, but it'll, how many kids, like, there's been some studies done, like playgrounds around, like there's nobody on the playgrounds anymore. Because the kids are all on their electronics, and then health issues for children now is ramping up for we're seeing that, and so it's important that they're doing other things besides being on the electronics. All right.
I think what's interesting too. I mean, we just moved here, 3 years ago, I think, and so I went on those websites like, what's there to do locally? What's there to do that's free? And sometimes we forget to look in our own backyard.
Yeah. Yeah.
Put some fun time into.
Yeah, put a fun time in. Phil, you can go to the next screen. I just said, I got permission to share this, working with a father just the other day, and he showed me on his cell phone. He's now spending more time with his kids, in particular his son, having good connection time with him as he's overcome some challenges in his life. And so the fun thing they did the other day with all this snow, he built this igloo with his son. And then he took a bottle with some and colored water, and then they were spraying it all over the igloo. So it is a multicolored igloo, and the kid was just—he said it was the most fun he's had in years with his kid. And so again, building in those times where you're connecting with your children, and I just encourage this young father. So you keep doing that; that's going to pay you big dividends down the road. So next thing. So we got the ideal week. Working on that. The next thing in your handout there is a family meeting. This is another one. It'll take some patience and some work. You have in your handouts, I'm not going to go through the whole thing, but I have a whole guide in here on how to do a family meeting. Gretchen and I did this not really consistently, but we did this with our kids and meet with them and talk with them about the week. I, again, have found this to be a huge help in my life and in the life of those that I work with. I also learned it when working residential, working in a men's home and also at His Mansion Ministries, that having these times together with everybody who's in the community at the table. So we did this with a program that I started up in His Mansion. It was called Sociogram. And it was an opportunity for the residents to give each other feedback, both positive, they had to come in to encourage, but also to challenge others in the program. And it got pretty sparky at times, but it was a way to build connection. No matter what the counseling paradigm is, there's some of them, cognitive behavioral therapy, which I use, and psychodynamic, all have research behind them to show that they are helpful to people. But yet, all of them, out of all the paradigms, the one thing, what do you think is like the biggest thing that makes a difference in counseling? Anybody know?
Relationship.
It's a relationship with the person that's in your room. It's about the relationship and the quality of that relationship. So it's going to be the same for your family. It's about the quality of the relationship. So this is a way to build that connection and have conversation. So you will see, again on your handout, setting a regular place and time, having a place to meet, setting an agenda, having ground rules. Some you can go real fancy with that. Some keep it very simple. I have one family that is now doing this on Sunday afternoon after church. They have a electronic free time, and they do a family meeting. And they just come to the table and they talk about the week ahead, but they also, the father steps in and does the reading, and he actually now is having some of his kids do some of the reading, and they talk about the scripture, and they pray. So you're modeling. Look, one of the most powerful things that you can do for your children is model to them the behavior you want them to emulate. You got to model it. The adage, you know, the old adage of do as I say, not as I do, is bogus. I don't want to curse the church. Bogus.
Baloney.
All right, yeah, it's baloney. We need to model our behavior for our kids. Same with our faith practices. So family meetings are a great place to do that. Others do it. I have another family, they do it right. They do it, actually, they just sit at the table. They do it, I recommend it. I know it's kind of old fashioned now, but they have a family meal together. And they do it right at the table, and then they share what's going on for the day. They just talk about the day, and they share some scripture, and they pray just 10 or 15 minutes. And they give me feedback. Sometimes that'll go on for 30, 40 minutes sometimes. As the kids have gotten used, this is a time where we can connect with our parents.
Yeah. I just want to say that stepping into something small changes will make big changes. And I'm thinking from my brain, it would be like, oh, this is great, we're gonna do it just like that. And I would set up this whole thing, and then it would fail, and then I would be controlling and naggy, and it was awful. So calm down.
You want to make it a positive experience. Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And let the kids have some say.
And make it fun. I have an idea there. Essentially, I had another therapist that I'm working with, down the Griswold. We're talking to her about being down the Griswold, but she does it with the kids. So she took a soccer ball, and on the white area on the soccer ball, she wrote questions. And so they toss the soccer ball, and wherever you catch it in your thumb, wherever your right or left thumb touches the white, you've got to answer that question. So just some fun things like that. Beanbag, you know, the only person that can talk is the person that has I can see some people throwing beanbag at each other. So just trying to incorporate some fun, and again, getting these built into your practice. And again, this is going to take commitment, it's going to take time. Your kids are probably going to resist it at first, especially if they're kind of middle school teenage years.
How would you, I'm just trying to think in a context of having a four-year-old and a two-year-old.
Yeah.
Like, what would that look like with, like, small children?
Yeah, it probably needs to be...
I mean, we can have conversation, but it's going to look different.
It's going to look different than yeah. And actually, if you look at my handout, I think I talk about that in there. When they get a little older, six, you know, once they're into school, it's a little easier to do these kinds of meetings. So I would make them more fun.
Okay.
Just time together. Maybe you sit in a circle on the floor with a beanbag and just talk that way.
Yeah, I think with the kids.
I know you guys. You guys have animals. You know, great. And, you know, talking about God's creation, mm-hmm. about the animals, and
would reading just, a book be yeah. a good thing?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's kind of focused on.
Anytime you're spending with them, yes, reading a book is a good way to do it. Drawing together. Just sit down and have some paper and have some time to draw together, work on a puzzle. Play-Doh. That's actually not...
Play-Doh.
Well, you guys are bringing up all kinds of memories with my kids. So Play-Doh, my ADHD daughter, Play-Doh was like, she loved Play-Doh. She loved Lincoln Logs and what are those plastic things that clip together? Lego, she loved those things. So those are ways to sit and play with her and just interact. Mm-hmm. Wrestle with the kids. My daughters were just great, especially the ADHD, just loved jumping on my back sometimes, unexpectedly.
Yeah, I caught her on top of the refrigerator with an umbrella because she thought she was going to be Mary Poppins.
She wanted to be Mary Poppins.
Yeah.
Jump off the fridge.
Yeah. And we had it, I'll tell another quickly.
That's
we had
a teenage, yeah. Go ahead.
The ADD was great because it got her into trouble because she forgot to clean up her antics. Uh-huh.
There was breadcrumb story.
Yeah. And so there was a trampoline and a pool, and it was probably not a good idea to have them next to each other, but it was fun. And we lived in a ranch, and the ladder was left out. And so I knew she went up the ladder, on the roof, on the trampoline, and in the pool.
So she was jumping off the roof of our house.
Did you?
The trampoline.
No! I said, Kirsten, you left the ladder out.
So that our kid is still alive.
I used to tell her.
Yeah.
You're so good, and you're so sneaky, and you're so high IQ, and you're so smart. I said, why don't you learn how to smuggle Bibles into China? Yeah. You know, those skills are for something good, and they're there for something good. And right now, she's a busy girl. She married an army guy, and they're living in Germany, and they're moving to Hawaii, and they were in Ireland for St. Patty's Day, and she's been to Paris, and I'm like, Jesus, only you. Only you can make it. And her husband is 8 years younger than her, because that, with the ADD, that's, they're very much younger than what, you know, and so they're like perfect age, and he's kind of an old soul, and they kind of meet in the middle somewhere around 26. And only God could do that. Amazing.
So, family meetings, any other questions there or thoughts? Connection time, that's a big thing. If you've got teenagers, great way to have a conversation is in the car. Put the cell phone down. When my daughter was dead, was when we had some great conversations. It was in the car. We got trapped for a little bit. So, okay. So ideal week, setting that up. I strongly encourage getting a family meeting in there somewhere on the schedule. It's also, even for you, for parents here, to talk about, we're doing good. Is having a time together that you're talking about the week. Again, you either talk about the week and plan for it, it'll plan for you. Now, things will happen during the week, you may need to make adjustments, but it'll pay you again big dividends if just a husband and wife sit down. Gretchen and I do it either Sunday night, or because of the business, we do it Monday morning. We have an actual meeting. We sit face to face on the couch, both of our calendars out. What's going on this week? What do we got to get done? And then we work on the week, and then we're just clicking away through it. It's also, there's something real beneficial about setting aside time for play. And so, how many here procrastinate? I should see every hand. We all procrastinate. Our coach, we have a guy who's helped us tremendously in our lives and in our business, and he's coming out with a book on procrastination shortly, so we look forward to getting that. But it's like a disease. I think I'm going to have another diagnosis for procrastination. It's like you're kicking the can down the road, hoping things are going to change next week, do it tomorrow. And how many times do you catch yourself doing that? Tomorrow, mm-hmm. And it's a disease. So procrastination is the enemy of success, I believe. Procrastination is the enemy of success. And so putting that time together and scheduling for time for, what I was thinking about was playtime. And you will then have, I don't know, it just works. Because if I've committed to my schedule, and I've done what I've needed to do as best I can for the week. And then when I have downtime, I have downtime. It's like you can park it. You can like park your week on the calendar, your to-do list. I also recommend doing a to-do list. I don't have it in here. But having a list of tasks that you get through and checking them off is another great way. Again, get it out of your brain, put it on paper, and it just reduces anxiety. And then give yourself permission. So this afternoon, we're doing something to support a recovery ministry down in Plainfield. And then tomorrow afternoon, we come home, it's going to be just downtime. It's just downtime. I'm probably going to play some bluegrass over in Rhode Island with some people. So just fun. Did I tell you about that?
No.
No. We forgot to talk about it. It's on the schedule. I realize
it's winging it.
And that's my winging it, see? So we need to talk about that. And I'll promise if you don't like it, I won't go. All right. So modeling here. Mutual submission. Yes?
I think those two play together, like you say. If you've got a plan, if you've got a schedule, then you know what you're doing when you take some time off.
Yes, absolutely.
You know that you're stepping out of the grid for a while, yeah. But the grid's still there, and you laid it out, so you feel free to ad lib for a while.
Yeah.
Because you know what you're playing.
Free to enjoy.
Yeah. What happens when we don't do it purposefully, we get into a place of entitlement. And entitlement will get you in big trouble because you're entitled to this, you're entitled to that, and I work hard. And then you don't even enjoy it when you're doing it because you're doing it out of entitlement or out of anger.
Yeah.
And we lived there for many, many years.
Yep. Or my spending was a result of entitlement thoughts, you know? So yeah. I deserve to have a motorcycle. I deserve to have time for myself. So those are things are all that is all self-focused, selfish behavior. So yet understanding that it's also a result of anxiety. If my life is chaotic and I have a lot of anxiety, we need to do something with it. And so we're going to, you know, put it into different energies. Mm-hmm. And that's why people get stuck in addictions, because they begin to use to quell the anxiety, to change their mood. And for some people with the vulnerability of the brain, they get hooked into the addiction. And then they've got a big problem, right? After a while, the addiction is running their life. We call it running a gun. So, all right, so having that downtime, again, it you can park it and you give yourself permission. I think there's a God above and he talks about having that Sabbath rest. He knew what he was talking about when he created that. And so for me, a Sabbath rest, although we have things scheduled on Sunday, but Sunday for me, it's just a time of kind of loose. We go to church. We have maybe a couple of things to do. But other than that, it's what I call a loose connection today. If I feel like working on the house and doing some carpentry, I do it. If I feel like sitting and reading, that's what I do. If I feel like going for a walk with my wife, we'll do that. Maybe we'll go out and listen to some music. I love listening to live music. So just having that, that's what a Sabbath rest. We need to rest our brain, that we don't have some goal-directed all-the-time behavior, because that'll just wear you out over time. Some of the best times I remember as a kid certainly was the fun times. My dad was actually good with six kids. One of our, we'll talk about routines for connection when we come back, but one of some of our best times together was when I had him, I have six kids. So if I had dad alone in the car by myself, that was a great time. I actually learned how to work well because I figured out my brothers, they would rather go play, but I figured if I work, I get time with dad. So it was a self-imposed performance mentality that I did, but it was time with dad. And so cutting wood, by the time I was 12, I was using chainsaw in the woods and cutting firewood. By 14, I was selling firewood and doing those kinds of things. So, but that connection time is huge. And so individual, my daughters, dads, I implore you, take your daughters out for a meal, take them out to do something with them. It would pay, you know, again, model to them how a man ought to treat a woman, you know? And that would just be a great thing. So I would do that with my daughters. It was breakfast on Saturdays was a big thing for my daughters. So I would switch every week, take one of them to breakfast. And we had a local diner that we went to, and that was like a regular routine. When the kids learned to drive, when they were learning how to drive, how many of you get nervous with the teens learning to drive? Like, wow.
Me say, wow, I taught him how to drive standard.
She did the standard. But what we did is we spent, look, the best way to help them learn to drive is they got to spend time behind the wheel. So go, and you have no excuse in this area of Connecticut to get on a back road and do some driving with your kid and teach them how to write. It's just that time with them. I have to say, my dad, he just, I said, I want to learn how to drive the truck, and he threw me the keys. He said, go ahead. that was, okay. Page 6 of your handout. Strengthening connections. So, the first half we talked about some ways in which you can reduce chaos by doing a schedule, having family meetings, and those are some wonderful tools to help support you in that process. Strengthening connection, we're going to talk now about how to build some stronger connection and relationship, and I'm guessing there's going to be a lot more questions in this section, and certainly there's not as much material here in the last part, so we can accommodate those questions. This whole seminar, in fact, some of the tools that I'm about to use today, one of them is called the EIAG method, E-I-A-G. And that whole process, I've actually taught that in a 5-day seminar. So I'm giving you kind of the top coating of it, like the frosting on the cake. And strengthening the connection, improving communication. Ephesians, scriptures for your consideration. Submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. For me, when working with couples, right, before we even talk about the roles, which Ephesians talks about, this whole principle of submitting one to another, how does that practically work out in life? I hear chuckles, I hear smiles, I see smiles. How does that work out? How do we mutually submit one to another in life?
Like giving in?
It could be. It could be. You know, sometimes it could be giving in. It could be listening well. You know, sometimes I've had to learn that I just need to do this, you know?
Yeah.
That it's not all about me. And it's not about me getting my way. And so I often tell all the couples I work with, I tell, look, fighting is a choice. We choose to fight. And there's different ways to talk, and you'll see a little bit here about that. But that's a submitting one. So if I love Jesus, he loves me, am I going to show my wife that same respect and submitting one to another and listening? Again, getting out of the way, my way of thinking. How many of you ever said, you say something, I did this for someone who was up here before, it's like this is a couple and you're having some conversation, you're trying to talk maybe about the kids, and you get into a fight, right? I call this the crazy eight of couple communication. So you say, man, I'm so frustrated with these kids. You say that to your wife goes, well, if you would only, right? And then there comes the criticism and the fight is on. So we often, how many of you ever had, like, you know, you're fighting about something a little while later, so what were we even fighting about? I don't remember what we were fighting about. Because we get into these dynamics of problems. So, well, again, the tool later, you'll see a little more of this. Philippians and Galatians, serve one another in love. Consider the others more important than yourselves. Oh, well, there's a practical way. Consider that others' opinions might be more important than yours.
Yeah, that's the one.
That's the one. If you can get that. Start.
That means that 100% all 3 of my kids are mad at me right now. For like completely different, unrelated reasons. All 3 are mad at me right now. For those of you who struggle with math, that means that 100% of my children are angry with me right now. And you know what? I don't care. I don't care. You know why? Because I am not their buddy. I am their parent. They are angry at me because I parented them. My number one job as their parent is to love them. And loving them does not mean making sure sure they're always happy and get every single little thing they want. Loving them means raising them into healthy, decent human beings who I would actually want to hang out with someday. That's what loving them is. Until my kids are adults, I am not their friend. We are not on the same level. I'm the authority. My child's well-being is more important to me than my child's opinion of me. My job is not to be liked by my kid, and I don't take it personally when my kid doesn't like me. And honestly, if my kids like me 100% of the time, I'm probably failing at parenting. So listen, parents. I know this parenting thing is really, 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 really hard. I know. And I know you're trying to do the right thing, and you're trying to be strict when it's necessary, and then your child gets upset at you, and then you give in. Don't do that. Don't give in. Hold your ground. And I hear some of you parents say things like, oh, my little kid is my best friend. That sounds really cute and all, but let's just be honest. If you're like 30, 40 something, and your best friend is an 8-year-old, that's just weird. It's weird. Don't be so insecure and desperate for your kid to always like you. Parent your child and then find friends your own age. Now here's the thing. If you're trying to do the right thing and parent your children, them not liking you is not terminal. It's not going to last forever. You know what's terminal? Them turning into entitled, bratty adults the rest of the world now has to deal with. That's terminal. But them not liking you, that's not going to last forever. At least one brand of ice cream at your grocery store right now is on sale. So go get it.
One of the ways that you can build connection is kind of likened to this, we talked about it a little bit in the first part, is creating opportunities, rituals for connection. In your, again in your handout, you will see a sheet that's like creating shared meaning. And you can go down this sheet, and there's like, I put 43 items on here, you could probably come up with more. But you can actually, as a couple, you can sit down and do this separately, come together, have a conversation about what you would like to do together to build connection. Maybe if the kids are old enough, have them do this in one of your first family meetings. And talk about ways in which you want to build some connection. And yes, cleaning your house and doing chores is a way to build connection. One of the ways that Gretchen and I work on connection is actually folding laundry together, right?
We do.
A little bit. Anyways, we build, but I do the art.
Fold it because it's been sitting on the couch for 3 days. And he needs shirts.
Or I'll say, Gretchen, I'm out of underwear. We need some laundry done.
Oh, yes.
The underwear bandit comes to your
house. Oh, yes. Yes, yes, yes.
You open the drawer in the morning, I'm, So I have my wife and we're teasing each other here, but so she has ADD, and so there's been often times where I walk by the washing machine, it's spinning, but the clothes are on the floor. How many of you have done
that? Or the lid is up,
or the lid is
and
up,
the water's sat in the tank for 2 days, and then I gotta redo it, and
yeah,
it's
so,
okay, I love myself.
All right. We love each other, and we laugh about it.
Yes.
So building connection, could be shopping for groceries, any little thing, attending sports events. If your kids are doing sports, one of the deepest pains I've actually had to work with teenagers on is their parents not being there on sports and stuff.
Or picking them up late.
There's something special about that time. Just to have a parent, my dad, of course my dad did a lot of coaching, but he always, and my mom, they always attended as much as they could to functions. With six kids, I mean, they were running ragged when we were in high school. But they did it, and I tell you, those were special times. You just knew that your parent was there. It's like this last little bit of connection, especially in the teen years. And we have that opportunity to encourage them and to bless them and send them into a life set up for success, okay? So building those connections. So this is one thing that you can work on. Often I will hear people say things like, we don't have time to connect. We don't have time for each other. Things like that, again, limited thinking, but this sheet here helps you think about there are ways to connect. You're busy all week long, there's gotta be some time you can connect. And that's another way when you're doing your ideal week and you're doing your schedule, having those times to connect. One of the biggest things that I did when our kids were little was when I put them to bed and reading them the scripture, just praying with them. That's a great way to do it, especially for dads. I often will hear things like, Dad, sometimes mom is more of the one that's engaged in verbalizing spiritual activities or principles, and Dad may be a little bit stand-backish, but I encourage dads to get in there and to have a connection time with your kids and just to talk, have a conversation. The things that teenagers are facing and middle schoolers are facing right now, I mean, the things I can think about when people I'm working with just curl whatever hair I have left, right? Just, it's awful. The whole thing with sexual identity and all of that. What our kids need is a place to be able to talk about these things and an opportunity for you to be able to give them feedback and from where you're coming from with your worldview. And that is so important. The worldview is something that is taught and modeled. If you don't do it, the culture will. If you don't do it, the culture will. Okay? So they're being influenced. In fact, by the time your kids are in high school, they're spending more time in school with their friends and with teachers and others who are influencing the way they think about the world and life than they're spending with you, probably. Okay, so it's really important, especially the younger years, to build that in. When is a personality set for a child? What age?
Birth.
There are some things at birth. Yes, you can. If you've had multiple kids, you can say there's been a difference from them when they're little. About 5 or 6 years old, personality is set. That's why those years are so important for connecting, having fun. And how many of you had multiple kids? Some kids are afraid. Some kids just, our oldest daughter, she would just like, the youngest one would be wrapped around our legs, right? So some of those are kind of hardwired in from birth, yet you can really help them learn how to manage life in those early years. When are their moral values set? Pretty much set. Doesn't mean they can't change, but when are they pretty much set? What do you think? 9, 10, get close.
3.
Could be. Actually, they say about 10 to 12. By the time your kids are middle school, whatever you modeled in those first 10, 12 years, that's what has set their moral compass. Now they may change, they may make decisions for themselves, and that's a part of teen years, is individuation, is pulling away from your parents. Yet, as the scripture says, train up a child in the way he should go, right? And when he's older, he won't depart from them. So it'll always be there. The compass will be there. Even when they're making poor choices and life just, you know, kind of, and I'm on the other end of it, seeing the wreck that some kids make in their lives. Yet the kids who had that moral upbringing, there's something as a counselor, there's something we can grab a hold of to get them back to. But if they don't have that, their inner life is just a shipwreck. Okay, so it's a lot harder work to help them. All right.
I would say, you know, that was some really hard years with the girls, and they always knew where we stood with the Lord, and they always saw our relationship. And even if they have gone off and done this or that, and they know that there's a safety net here, and they know that that's Jesus, and they both have had their experiences with the Lord, I kind of say there's a difference between knowing God and following Him and serving Him. And I know they both have belief, they've had experience, but they haven't made Him Lord. They haven't done that step. And to love your child, even if they're in a bad place, I used to think, well, how can I love my kid? And aren't I just condoning their sin? Aren't I condoning her behavior? And that was such a wrestling time for me. And the Lord just really, I can have boundaries and I can love them. These are the boundaries of the house. These are the boundaries of relationship. But I'll love you. And that took quite an adjustment for me, because I would be mad. I'd be mad and angry and disappointed for a long time. But
it keeps that communication open.
It keeps the communication open.
And it keeps, like, the love going, because that, yeah.
You can say you're not happy with their choices, right, but I'm going to love you as your mother. And make it verbally clear.
Well, especially with Kirsten, when she was going through some of those rough years, that she always knew she could call home and get daddy on the phone. Mm-hmm. And I had a word for her, you know? And that those words built up over time, and she started to make better choices for herself, doing much better today. But do our kids know that they can have a safe place to call when things aren't going well for them? And you know what, it's not about pounding, you know, because you could sit there and say, I told you, no, you know what, this sounds really difficult for you, I'm here to listen. Mm-hmm. I remember my daughter called me one time, I sat down outside, she was calling, going through some tough stuff. This boyfriend she had, the man in me wanted to track this man down and do him in. So that was the flesh side, the spirit side.
Fritz is a third degree black belt. This man here is third degree black belt. So best.
But the spiritual side of me took over, and I just sat down and had a conversation. And I remember saying these words. I said, you know, you called me often for support and help in what you're doing. I said, but I feel like I'm talking to a wall, and my voice isn't heeded, so I'm not sure what else to say. Just saying that opened up a whole conversation of her and I reconciling a lot of brokenness between us, which made her leave that guy. Thank God that she left that guy, made some decisions for herself. She needed to make that decision. She was already 19, 20 by this point. I could not rescue her. She needed to make the decision, but she was able to call home and have a conversation with her dad. Right. So this is what we're trying to do, is build up this communication process. So having these moments of connection and creating those shared meetings, you can think of all kinds of things. I used to wash the cars with my kids. Anything. My youngest one on the motorcycle. That was like her favorite thing, was to be on daddy, you know, just grab around me and we just go and have a bite to eat somewhere in a motorcycle. You know, anything like that to build connection with our kids. So I hope I've encouraged
you. The personality, I wish we, you know, you always wish you'd known their personalities. Yeah. And my younger daughter is more like her father. And mm-hmm. and she said, Mommy, remember that time where we picked blueberries and we brought them in the house and we made blueberry pancakes? And I'm like, no. Not at all.
Yeah.
And then the next year you cut the blueberry bush down? I'm like, no, don't remember that either.
And how sad that was for her.
And how sad that was for her.
Yeah.
No, I just remember the time that I decided to clean your room out, and I got four bags, and I threw everything in.
Yeah,
I was really tough. I was tough.
Needed to be.
But I had a daughter that needed a tough mother, and I used to say, Lord, you gave me this child, and I must be able to handle her. Mm-hmm. And but being so tough with one, I missed the sweetness of the other.
Yeah. Okay, I'm on page 7 of your handout. Yes. Yeah.
About the personality thing, kind of slightly going back to what you said, what kind of things are set in them already? They're getting closer to 5. What kind of stuff do I have influence, positive
over
or negative, mm-hmm. in their personalities? I know it's a moment.
So there's, I'd be hard pressed at the moment to list all the like hardwired traits, but some of them would be like extrovert versus introvert. And so we know, how many of you have done the Myers-Briggs inventory? Some of you may have done the Myers-Briggs. So those are some hardwired set traits. So introvert, extrovert, whether you're more of a feeler or a judger, those are some of the things that are hard set. So, but what we can have influence in, so an introvert is somebody who likes time to themselves to re-energize, downtime, reading, time alone, right? That's hardwired. Now, what that can lead to, though, is that they have difficulty in social situations, that raises up more anxiety, and so then they would tend to pull away from that and stay with themselves. And we know that's not good, they need to learn how to interact with the world. So there's a balance there of, okay, my youngest one was this way, very much an introvert. Yet one of the things we used to do is when we went to Dunkin' Donuts or McDonald's or something, we'd have our kids order their food. And the oldest daughter, no problem, right up there. And she'd order too much. But the youngest one, no, Dad, no. And so we push her along and encourage her to speak up for herself. And I think that's paid some good dividends for her. So that would be an example. So thinking about what those traits are and how I can influence. The other thing that I think about is understanding, and that'll get into the one other section here, but understanding what are my kids thinking about? what's going on in their mind. They have their minds too going on. So I can influence the way they think about things. Tell me what you're thinking about. What's another way to think about this? What might the scripture say about this? Or how helpful is that thinking for you right now? Mm-hmm. And that's where you can have influence in the way they think. And that requires you to be able to be a good listener and not get upset when you hear things that you're like, oh, just wait.
Yeah, it's interesting. I used to, you know, yell into the, we lived in a ranch, which was good because I had to keep my eyes on the other one.
Could
I can tell you a thousand pet stories too.
Oh, goodness, yeah.
But when the younger one came along, she could entertain herself. The other one, if she was alone and quiet, it was trouble. There was messes and there was things. So I would forget to shift, and I'm like start yelling for Amanda, and I'd go and I'd find her, and she'd be sleeping, she'd be, you know, reading. So I had learned with the second one to just quietly go find her, so that and the younger one, Amanda, she's jumped out of a plane twice. My shy, absolutely shy child. She's been the same job in high school, through college, and now, and she keeps moving up in this company because the thought of interviewing and moving, she's got to like buy special t-shirts to wear, like she sweats, like she's so nervous. She just, that's how she's wired. And as much as me, the entrepreneur, wants to try and do all these new things, I accept that in her and maybe help her along. If I have some jobs, website jobs or whatever, she's a good writer, so I'll have her do some writing. But they are who they are. And I had the two girls probably about 5 years ago take Enneagram, which is another kind of personality test. And I read the results and I'm like, I should have never been your mother. I completely missed each of you. Like the adventure ladder on the house one, you know, she scored high in adventure and new things. And then the other one was, yeah.
Yeah.
But God does that, right? He does that because that's where we stay on our knees.
Yeah. Amen. All right, page 7. Ephesians 4, I'm going to push along here. That for me is a huge verse. Let no corrupting talk come out of your mouths, but only such as good for building up. Circle that, building up, and fits for the occasion, that it may give grace to those who hear. Circle grace. Is our conversation the type that builds others up and gives grace? Mm-hmm. This ought to be the verse before a business meeting in the church. Mm-hmm. Is it building up and building grace into another person's life? Don't grieve the Holy Spirit by whom you've been sealed for the day of redemption. Why is that in there? Why do you think that was put in there? Don't grieve the Holy Spirit.
What we say matters to God.
What we say matters to God, exactly. Interestingly, isn't it, that the way we speak and talk to each other can grieve the Holy Spirit? So let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you, along with all malice. Be kind, tender-hearted, forgiving, just as Christ forgave you. Boy, oh boy, this, we just like put this, tattoo it on our arm and just walk this out in relationship especially, and you will have amazing transformation in there. In the relationships. I believe we must move from the head to the heart with this principle. I may be convinced of my way of thinking. I may be convinced that I need to control the situation, but I can get out of that and get to the heart, because that's the heart is about our emotions, our mind, will, and emotions, our heart, and open ourselves up to others that will make a big impact on relationships. So the four horsemen of the apocalypse. Are you able to flip that one? See that picture there? So some of you, the revelations of four horsemen of the apocalypse. Can anybody name those four horsemen, or did I put it in here?
It's in here.
It's in here, yeah. Now think about this. What I'm about to share, these four horsemen will wreak havoc in your marriage and in your family. And this has been studied. Almost 30 years worth of study that this came out of. And think about these four horsemen you think about these four horsemen as a conquest or pestilence, war, famine, and death. Think about the conflict in your family. Think about the chaos. sometimes when we're talking with others, it's all about me trying to control the other person. And so that's the conquest. I'm trying to conquer the other person by my point of view. And then we've created war. Our fighting and our conflict creates war in our families. And this pestilence, it's so damaging. Recent study that I was reading, we often hear when, and I know divorces happen, divorce is very painful, and there's reasons for it, and without going into that conversation, but yet understand, there's a statement that, you know, my husband and I are going through a divorce, and we're really trying to keep the conversation apart from the kids. The thing is, they now know that kids, they know when mom and dad aren't getting along. Even if it's not being seen, they know. There's something in their spirit that just knows things aren't working. And so that is something to understand. Research has just proven that out. And so it's causing death. Famine, just the starvation. Starving for connection, starving for building of relationships that are healthy and help us. So this information you'll see in your handout, the Four Horsemen of the Apocalypse. And this comes out of the Gottman research. And though they focus it on couple relationships, I see it in families. I see it in business interactions. So it's criticism and contempt, defensiveness and stonewalling. Criticism is this, it's a labeling of a person. You always, you never. It's black and white type thinking. It's generalizations. You're a slob. That gets in more into contempt, right? It's the way we speak to each other. You know, something happens at home. I'm so frustrated. You never do, like the underwear not being clean. You never do the laundry. You're always, I don't know what's wrong with you. That's contempt, right? That ought not to be the language between couples, ought not to be the language coming from a person who says they believe in Jesus Christ and been sanctified by the Holy Spirit. It's unwholesome talk. Amen? So, contempt is that name-calling, and I've seen it, and maybe you've used it. I just, like, strike that out. It's the biggest predictor of divorce. The level to which these four horsemen are active in your marriage is correlated to the happiness in your relationship. The more they're used, the less happy the relationship. Contempt and its use of contempt, if it's not stopped, will predict usually divorce within 5 years of a marriage coming together. It needs to get out. It needs to be just like shown the door, get out, okay? So defensiveness is like seeing yourself as the victim, warding off a perceived attack. You know, it's making excuses. Not my fault, I didn't. Or if someone comes at you and says something like, you never, you all, well, if you were doing it, right? Remember we talked about that crazy eight before, we're often arguing about something, we don't even remember what we're arguing about, but then we go on the attack, we're attacking the person's character. cross-complaining, it's not true, you're the one who, so forth, so on. Yes, but, yeah, but, that's another thing I really try to get out of my life is the word but, right? Get the butts out of your life. I know they're in the scripture, but anyways, get the butts out of your life. What does but, so if someone's trying to share with you and you immediately say but, what does that do? It negates what the other person just said. So you would respond to it differently. You'd say something like, oh, okay, I'm hearing you say this. I disagree with that. Here's what I'm thinking. So it's like I'm honoring the other person's opinion. Yes?
I've always tried to change whenever I'm about to say but, it's however.
Yeah.
So you're acknowledging what the other person said.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a better word to use. Okay, stonewalling. 80% of men are stonewallers. And I'm an expert at it. Stonewalling. What is stonewalling? It's a turning away from the
conflict. Tell our stonewall story.
You can?
Yeah.
Go ahead. All right. I'm on the spot.
Fritz and I were going to paint our daughter's bedroom together. Such fun. And so.
I don't remember this, but go
oh,
ahead.
Yeah, you'll remember it. So we're going to paint
the
bedroom together.
I shame coming on right
and,
now.
So he decided, he realized that we needed something out of the store. You know, you always need something Home Depot when you get going.
Oh, I do.
So I said, all right, I'll get started. I'll do a wall. I did one wall. I did another wall. And this is before cell phones.
Yeah.
Right? We gotta come up with a BC, a BCP or whatever. And so the phone rings, someone's looking for Fritz. I said, well, he should be home soon. He's just going to the store and, you know, we're painting a room together and he should be home soon. No Fritz, no Fritz. I paint the other wall. Phone rings again. Did Fritz get back yet? Nope. He's not back yet. I paint the ceiling. And Fritz comes home. When he was out going to the store, the Taekwondo school needed some help with their electrical work.
Oh.
And it was way more fun to help the guys do
electrical work. Over painting.
Yeah. So he came home, but he doesn't verbalize anything because he's never been much of a verbalizer. He has a twin sister who's like me, who did all the talking for him, so he's never had to verbalize. This is a learned skill, verbalizing for this man.
Yeah.
Shared the womb with a woman, has two daughters, and we had all female dogs and cats.
Yeah.
So he comes home and, you know, of course, by then I'm beyond ranting, beyond furious, beyond. Screaming, yelling. I screamed and yelled so much, I wet my pants. I was foaming at the mouth. And he stonewalled the whole time.
That's, yeah.
And then he went out and he got on the lawnmower. And our little motorcycle daughter got on the back with him, the younger one.
Yeah.
And boom! And I was just... Beyond.
So I was a conflict avoider.
And
that was an extreme example, but anyway.
Well, it happened.
I'm so sorry about that.
It's okay. We have recovered.
Oh, dear,
I'm just
dear.
Trying to be. Yeah. Recovery is a great thing. It he is a different man.
Yeah.
He does yoga now. Come on. Yeah. It's Taekwondo to yoga. Like, but there's hope. Is what I'm saying.
There's always hope.
Yeah.
For change. Yeah, so stonewalling, it's a turning away, it's not engaging.
But, you know, he could have said, possibly, I really
I could
hate
have
painting.
Apologized.
Well, no, just that, even in the beginning. I hate painting, I'd love to help with the room, is there a different way I can help? Or, you know, it's conversation.
Yeah, have
conversation.
Yeah, so stonewalling is a turning away. So it could be, you know, so if Gretchen was going on one of her rants, it's like me putting on the blinders like this, like a horse with the blinders, like, I don't want to deal with it right now. I'm telling you, I just want to watch football. I wonder what my buddies are doing on their motorcycles. We're kind of, you know, and I'm thinking all this because I'm trying to get away from her, right? So it's avoiding, that's what stonewalling is. And so part of the work here is learning how to have conversations. And again, we're going to have you go through this. On the back side of your paper is the remedies for the Four Horsemen. Again, I'm putting this out here. I hope just to build an awareness into your relationship that these things need to be worked on. You can go on YouTube. The Gottmans have plenty of videos on the Four Horsemen and how to get over them. And if you're really struggling, then give me a call and you can come see Daniel or I, and we'll work on you with these things. So, but learn to be. Specific, and I always talk about promises and requests, you know, and I need to make a direct request. For instance, the not having underwear in the drawer, if I can use that again. Maybe I'll go with socks. For some reason, underwear just, anyway, go with socks, not in socks and underwear. So I could, man, you, when are you going to do the laundry? I'm so tired of going to the drawer and not having socks to wear to work, right? That's and I could jump on her and just, it's like an exasperating complaint, right? Rather than, honey, I need socks. Can you do a load of laundry for me today? That's a direct request. And then she's able to respond, right? If she says yes, she needs to do it. She just made a promise.
Yeah.
When she asks me, honey, I'm really stressed out. I really could use you to go to the grocery store and pick something up for us tonight. Would you please get... And if I say yes, I just made a promise. This would be huge in your relationships, to work on promises and requests. Teaching your kids to make a request. When they're screaming and crying and carrying on, what's going on? What do you need? Make a request. Talk to me. Tell me what you need. Right? Get out of the complaining and screaming. And if you as a parent promise, this is another thing that I've seen. Something I had to work through with my kids. I had many broken promises with my kids. And so how often I hear from people, you know, the parents said this, they would do this, they never did it. They weren't people of their promise. This, I'm telling you, getting these four horsemen and learning to be people of commitment and promises and requests will rise you above the cultural norm right now. I personally believe, as Christians, that the divorce rate is almost as high as it is in the regular culture. So, but if we, as people of promises and requests and commitment, if we keep our word, we will rise above the culture. And then, as Paul says, we have an opportunity. Why are you different? Now you have an opportunity to speak about your faith. Now you have an opportunity to say, why am I different? Right? So these are just great ways to think about interacting with our family. So, you'll see more of the remedies right there, validating, shifting to appreciation. There ought to be, the happiest couples have 5-to-1 ratio, some studies show 7-to-1 ratio of appreciations, comments of our uplifting versus a complaint. Complaining is okay. You know, I'm really frustrated with the laundry. Can you take care of that? That's okay. We need to talk that way and make a request. But I also need to have those appreciations, and those could be a hug, you know, on the shoulder. My wife likes to be kissed on the top of the head. You know, any kind of show of affection is, that needs to be 5-to-1, way outweigh the criticisms, way outweigh the complaints. And most relationships and families, when it's the other way around, someone was just talking earlier, when it's the other way around and there's a lot of complaining and fighting and stuff, if you were to score it, if someone were to watch your family and score, you will see it's way flipped the other way. So one of the things I tell parents when your kids, if you're really struggling with teenagers and they're not opened up, is this isn't going to happen overnight. So you begin the process of showing appreciation. Little things. Catch the little things that they're doing well. And give them appreciation. Thank you for doing that for me. I appreciate it when you talk, when you speak to your sibling that way. I appreciate it when you do that for, man, I saw you do something for mom the other day. That was so good that you did that for your mother. Right? And catch it. And when our brains are so focused on the anxiety and fear that we're dealing with, it's hard. There's a phenomenon. How many of you had a particular car that you like or you just bought, and then all of a sudden you see them all over the place all the time? Yeah, Nate, you're thinking about Mustang. I know you're thinking Mustangs, right? so you start to see them all over, and it's like, I don't know about you, but as a guy, when I start seeing those, it's like calling to me. I want a Mustang 5.0 at least. And you know, you just start thinking that way and you start to see it. Our brains naturally, whatever we're focused on, we begin to take in that information. Confirmation error, they call it. And what happens is I start to see those things and I screen out other things. It's just the way your brain works. It's a survival technique. So
right, and sometimes it's
what do you think?
Well, state like behaviors in a person.
It could be. So if
you screen out some of the nice things you see in your wife, but when you're looking at someone else at work, and then all of a sudden, then you're gonna see all the negativity of your wife because you're trying to build a case for this.
Right. Think about it. Think about the complaining. It's usually attacks. So you're focused on that, and if that's what you're focused on, that's what you're gonna see all the time, and you'll screen out the opportunities. How often I hear, well, I don't see anything good, and I'm like, that just can't be. That can't be. 24 hours, 7 days a week, there isn't anything you can see in your family or your spouse or your child that it's there. You open up the heart, open up the mind, and to look for it. And you'll begin to see it. Share it, and that'll begin to build into the relationship. So any relationship that I've seen work through the challenges that they're facing in counseling or even in coaching, the ones who get a hold of this make significant improvements in their relationships in the house. It's amazing. It works. I'm telling you, it works. And so to get a hold of this will just, again, pay big dividends in your relationships. You're rewriting the scripts. You're doing something different. What's the definition of insanity? Doing the same thing and expecting a different result. So you need to change, do something. This is where change is possible. You can change the way you speak. Maybe you need to I actually learned that from a friend of ours, but maybe you need to put the duct tape on. It goes both ways. If I'm being criticized, rather than get defensive, mm-hmm. I'll say something like, I can see you're upset. Please tell me what you need from me. Right? She may have come, you know, with an attack at me, but I don't have to respond. So it's both ways. I need to change the way I talk, but I also need to change the way I react. Because people make mistakes. Mm-hmm. They may act out. So empathy is a big one. We'll talk about that in a moment. So four horsemen. Any questions on that before I flip the page here? That's a big one. All right. Listening well. You've heard this before with communication. The biggest complaint when couples seek counseling is that we aren't communicating well. That's like almost always one of the biggest complaints, is that we aren't doing well. And I would, it's usually because of the four horsemen, but it's also because they're not listening well. James says, you know this, my beloved, let everyone be quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to anger. So, quick to hear, you may have heard it before, but God's given us two ears and one mouth. So we ought to be listening twice as much as we're talking. And for some people, that talking just keeps going and going and going, right? That wasn't because...
That was obvious.
That was a Freudian.
What's interesting is in practicing this, mm-hmm. and for Fritz, I know for me to feel listened to, and I'm sure it's for most people, is the eye contact.
Yeah.
Or if we're chatting on the phone and I hear his computer going, and I'm like, honey, I really need you to stop with the computer and really listen to what I'm saying. Or he'll go, like the video that we saw.
The video.
And I said, you didn't get that one. Nope, I'm sorry, you're right. Okay, back up, I missed that whole paragraph. And so this has just been the back and forth that we're honoring each other, and in with our lives being full, like all you guys have full lives, is backing up and saying, I need instead of you always.
That's a great way, because it's so me not, so you not getting defensive and just calling my attention to my behavior in the moment, and then I can make the repair, say, I apologize, let me pay attention. So it's just a great way. We've learned how to do that and not get offended. And certainly I need to work on paying attention right away, put the phone down, whatever. But there will be times when I make a mistake, and then my wife can point it out. And then I can make the repair, apologize, get back to what we need to do. Make sense? I can listen well. So, conscious listening creates understanding. One of the most sincere forms of respect, somebody said this earlier, it's about respect in families, is actually listening to what the another person has to say. This is a difficult thing with teenagers, especially when you get the disrespect. They're going to lash out, they're going to be disrespectful. The challenge, I think, is that how we respond to that disrespect. If you respond in anger, like, how dare you, don't you talk to me that way? Well, the fight is on. But it's okay to say, I don't appreciate being spoken to that way. I'm going to say what I need to say again. And not buy into the fight. Look, the whole thing with dynamics is like, there's a way that it's been happening in the family for a period of time. And it's so easy for us to default back to the behavior we're familiar with, even if it's painful. God, come and straighten us out, right? So we default back into that behavior. So you need to change, and the first person you can change is yourself. If you begin to change the interaction you're having with your teens, I know it'll help. And so you can just, but I need to be careful about how I'm responding. So respect is built as I respectfully speak to them and then ask them, I want you to, you know, feedback to me what you heard. Just ask me what you need to ask and stay away from the disrespect. So I hope that's a little bit helpful. All right, listening well. Common hindrances. You're too busy thinking about what you're going to say to the other person, right? You're waiting for your moment to get in there so you can respond. Or we only listen long enough to figure out what the point of the other person's point of view that disagrees with us. So I'm listening, if this is in our political system right now, I don't know what is. Right, we listen long enough to find out what we disagree with, and then we attack. Instead of giving the person the opportunity to fully express what they're saying, we also know from research, a person is more likely to change the way they're thinking about a particular issue if they first feel or believe they've been heard. So you've got to give a person a chance to speak what's on their mind. We interrupt to spout our solutions before the problem has been fully identified. This is, my wife is a fixer, and the first thing she'll right away start thinking about the fixing. Here's what you need to do, da da da. And sometimes I've had to say, I just need you to listen right now, right? And so we want to step away and...
Yeah, it's very interesting. We'll go back to a little bit of personalities, because there are times when I need to dream verbally out loud, and I get very excited, and my voice raises, and I have all these ideas. And Fritz is in the details, and he's like, so I have to say to him, Fritz, I'm throwing out ideas. I'm not looking for answers. I'm not looking for solutions. Let's just dream. Let's just talk. Let's talk about the seminar. Let's just hash it out. And so then I'm not looking for anything from him, and vice versa. So yep. We now preempt what it is we need to say. So it's always in a different. This is a conversation that's important to listen to. This is a conversation that's, I need a response or help with. Mm-hmm. There are different conversations.
Yeah, to be clear about the purpose of it. So for me, sometimes I just need to talk what's going on. So I have, that's another thing for couples is building in an opportunity just to talk about the stresses of the day. One of the biggest things you can do, husbands come in if your wife is at home taking care of the kids and they're all stressed out, wigged out. One of the biggest gifts you can give them is to come in, give her a hug, give her a kiss, sit down and tell me about your day, what's going on, how can I help? Any mothers in here say amen to that? Louder, louder.
It doesn't take much.
So it doesn't take much. Just that little bit of attention will again, I keep using this word.
Connected to sex. Yeah,
it is? Yeah. So, yeah, that's a great, so that's a way, it's understanding what the stresses are and what can I do for you. Now, some people might come home and tell your wife what they ought to have done all day long or how they ought to do this or that. That's not helpful in the moment. What's helpful in the moment is just to listen and understand where your spouse is at. And again, then you can, together, well, how can I help? Other ways, can we deal with this differently? Okay, so that's empathy. You'll see here on the middle of page 8 I'm on. Ways of being. That's a common term. Is how am I interacting with the world? How do other people perceive me? Are you perceived as others as a peacemaker? I think there's a scripture about that somewhere. Right? Do they see you as a... as somebody who brings solutions to a problem? How are you walking out your life? One of the ways you can do it is communicate empathy. Empathy is the ability to get into the shoe of the other person and understand what it's like for them. Empathy is about me, some emotion connecting in me, connecting with the other person. I can't fully understand a client of mine who's been traumatized in sexual abuse. I can't fully understand that, but I can sit and listen. Just that listening alone is so healing for a person. There's stories I'll take to my grave that I've heard in my office. You know, but some of those, just a listening ear for that person, somewhere they can talk about the pain and the things that have happened in their life. So those things are so important. Be empathetic. It's vital to building understanding. It's different than sympathy. There's a great video on YouTube. Go on there and Google empathy versus sympathy and you'll see it. Sympathy is about if you're jumping right into the, well, you ought to do this, or you don't, you know, you need to pray about that. That's not empathy. You may feel sorry for them, but that's not empathy. Empathy is feeling with others. Maintain openness. Have the mindset, I could be wrong. Let me hear what you're saying. I could be wrong about my judgment, my assessment here. Let me hear. So maintain that openness, that way of being open. I believe Jesus was open. Where did he go? He went in. He went with the publicans and the tax collectors and the prostitutes and he went into parties, you know, and he was with people and he had conversations with them. He asked them about their life, and yet he knew exactly what was going on. right? But he was interested in other people. And so we're modeling that. We're modeling a way of being like Jesus. Communicate acceptance. Accept one another just as Christ so has accepted you. So I accept a person for who they are. God is, look, I see other people, even and other people in the world. They're a reflection of God's creation. God is so big. Each one of you is a representation of his creation in its uniqueness, right? And to see another person as that, that can, again, open up. I'm not excusing behaviors. Those can be talked about, but I need to accept the person. And then I can have a conversation with them, right? And so that's another thing that I'm thinking about, listening well. Are you in a place of judgment, or are you in a place of acceptance of the other? There's a place for using judgment, good, sound judgment on issues. But I don't want a judgment that pushes people away. Is not the judgment that we're called to. Okay. Any questions there before I flip the page? Listening well. There's a lot of material in this. You can go online for it. Okay. Here's something to think about. If you're a person of faith and you're in a room with people, you're in your business, wherever you work, think about this. What opportunity you have for other people. Rather than thinking about how I want to fight with somebody or argue with somebody, I have a different thought. And the thought is this. And it's not about pride, so hear me out. When I walk into a room, the opportunity for other people to be loved, to be heard, to be saved, to be healed, to be sanctified, just went up. Mm-hmm. Not because of me, but because of the Jesus that lives in me. Mm-hmm. That's a different way to approach life. Mm-hmm. Wherever you go, the person behind the counter at Walmart, the guy who fixes your car, wherever you go, you have the opportunity to presence the Holy Spirit, to presence an example of Jesus to other people. And that is what the world needs. It's what they'll always need, right? So, I'll get off my preaching stump there. Go back to listening.
Preach.
Yeah, page nine. Practice active listening. So you can remember this, when I was going to school, I don't memorize very well. I actually have a slight encoding problem. That's why me and math just don't work. I you ever get it? I just can't get it. I just don't get it. It just doesn't flip in my brain right. And then when it does flip, you ever had that experience? Like, oh yeah, now I understand. So how frustrating it is for people that really have a challenge with like dyslexia and things. But anyways, I used mnemonics when I was memorizing. When I went to seminary, we did so much reading. I was drowning in reading, right? Daniel and Leon could attest to this too, but it's like read and study and then test. Read and study and then test. So I had to do a lot of memorization. So RSA, mnemonics is just breaking things down into smaller bits of information. Your brain, that's why our, what's the series on our phone number? How many numbers? It's a total of seven, but what's it broken up to with the dashes?
Three.
Threes and fours. Your brain memorizes better in second series of threes and fours. That's why you put the dashes in. That's why some people are amazing at when memorizing a long number. If you break it apart, you'll be able to do it. And again, studies show the brain just is able to do it that way. So that's what mnemonics is, breaking it down. So receive, appreciate, summarize, ask. RSA, RASA. Rasa. It's receiving is having this posture of openness. So when I'm having a conversation with somebody, I need to be looking, you probably see me looking at my wife. I need to have this position. So it's not this. Or it's not when one of you come home from work and you're looking at the phone or something and they're talking to you and you're not paying attention. It's a turning, it's an openness, inviting conversation. It's appreciation. Let the speaker know that you appreciate what's being said. That can be verbally, or it can be the nonverbal cues. Or just putting my finger, you know, my finger to my chin. I'm thinking. I'm looking in the eyes of the person. All of that communicates appreciation. I appreciate who that person is, even if I really disagree with them. That I appreciate who they are as a person. Because I'm thinking, I'm going to have the opportunity here to connect with them. Right? So appreciate. Summarize. Reflect back to the speaker what you heard and check in. Well, I heard you say this. I heard you say it's so difficult. If I get a teenager example, what's a common teenager comment about school? Someone give me one. A complaint about school.
It's boring.
It's boring. School is boring. What's it like to go to school all day and be bored? That's empathy. That's summarizing. But what did that just do?
Validated them.
Acknowledge that they're bored. It also opened up for further conversation. Well, I don't know why you're so bored at school. You got classes, you got all your friends, you got sports, right?
I wish I was still in school.
So, and I'd love to go back to, yeah, but.
High school.
Yeah, so, right, so it's being, it's summarizing, it's being there, it's talking to them. What is it like to be bored at school all the time? What do you think that's about, Dar? Are there ways that we can overcome that, that you could overcome it? What are things you could do? Yeah, so that's the conversation to have with people, with teens, you know. Relationship, give me like a teenager relationship issue.
A friend isn't talking to them?
Yeah, so my friend, she won't talk to me anymore. Well, you know, maybe you just need to send them a message, send them an email, do a text, or maybe you can get to connect with them on Facebook. What did I just jump to?
Fixing
and solution. First, go to empathy. Man, I'm sorry to hear that your friend isn't talking to you anymore. Sounds like they were really important to you. That's a different way. Get them to talk, continue to talk about it. What did that friendship do for you? How important was that in your life? Then, once you heard them a little bit, then you can go to solution. That empathy is a step we often miss. And we're so in tune to wanting to jump to solution, okay? So I'm seeking clarification, I'm asking those questions. So that was an example of the rasa, is connecting. All right, any questions on that? Practice that at home. Practice it with one another at home. Last one, page 10. Discipline. I didn't put a whole lot in here. I wanted to say just a couple of things about discipline. There are many different styles of discipline. So whatever that style is, I'm not even going to get into in which styles of discipline you may want, but. Here are the things that I think are really important about discipline, and I have them there for you. I actually pulled this from Effective Parenting in a Defective World. I think it's a great quote. Far from being a dirty word, discipline is an evidence of love. That's why I showed you that video before. When you consistently discipline your child, you do it with the right attitude, compassionately, under control, with consistent boundaries and consequences, and focus on the child's best outcome. You are expressing love. It's the most selfless, compassionate thing you can do for your child to set them up for happiness in life. So what's your parenting style? One of the best books I think on discipline right now is Positive Discipline, and the other one is Raising Self-Reliant Children in a Self-Indulgent World. And that's where the EAG principle comes out of. I'll share that in a moment. Raising self-reliant children in a self-indulgent world. Or Positive Discipline, same author. Can you look them up? So there's lots of material on disciplining. I think the challenge for many families is that it's inconsistent, out of balance in some way, And I asked the question there, what's your style? What's your style? I have in there authoritarianism versus permissiveness, right? The authoritarian, what does an authoritarian say? My way or the highway. Do as I say. Now there's a place for boundaries in a family and what's acceptable and unacceptable behavior. I acknowledge that. However, if that's your only, the only way is your only style is authoritarian, that you rule the roost, it's my way, it's my house, this is the way you're going to do things. That's too far in the extreme. What's a pessimistic way? Or a permissive. I don't know why I say pessimistic. Permissive.
The kids rule the
roost. They can do whatever they want. Parents are too preoccupied. It's too much of a bother. Either one, either extreme, I'll guarantee you leads to rebellion. I'll guarantee it. I've worked with hundreds of young people. Hundreds. And when the households have been at these two extremes, it's a disaster for the kids. And they will rebel. Now, rebellion is a part of the teen years and it needs to be worked through. But the middle ground here, I believe the middle ground is authoritative. Mm-hmm. And that's built over time. That you're the authority in the house, but you're not authoritarian. So you can look these up on the internet and think about these. But that you're seen as the authority. There are rules in our house. There are rules. And in fact, when my daughter finally got to the place where she would no longer abide by the rules of the home, I remember the most difficult thing I ever did was get a suitcase and tell her, your time in my home, in your mom's home is done. You're moving out. You have, what do we give her?
Well,
I think we gave her 48 hours or something. Yeah. So there, it was a very difficult and very painful time in our life, but hopefully you don't have to get to that place with somebody. But it's, there is a place for this authoritarian. So you want to, and here's the thing that with parenting also, you want to be able to speak to your children in a way that communicates authority. So I often hear some parents who, what's the word I'm looking for? It's like, oh, why are you doing that? Don't you know that hurts your sister? So is understanding what cognitive level your kids are at. When they're this young, don't you know if you keep doing that, Johnny, that you're gonna down the road here, and you keep going and you're trying to explain to your child, that they lost you on the first sentence. Johnny, no, unacceptable, stop. That's authority. Stop the behavior. Authoritarian or is like some, what the hell's wrong with you? Excuse me, what's wrong with you? Why are you doing that? That is putting down, I'm telling you, that'll lead to rebellion in your kids too. You don't want to attack their character. You want to build them up. But so you just say, stop. And so speaking to them in an authoritative language, so you want to raise your voice a little bit with them, but you don't want to be screaming at them. If they're screaming at you, you actually want to come underneath. You don't want to meet them where they're screaming, you want to come underneath. So just some little tips here. But there's a big thing with discipline. So again, I didn't spend a whole lot of time on this. There's plenty of books on it. I encourage you, but be consistent. Yeah, de-escalating. When somebody's really ramped up, and angry, you want to come underneath them. You don't want to meet them head on. That's your death sentence. You want to come underneath. You want to de-escalate them. And then to get flooded. Maybe they need to take a break. Right? That's one of the things you learn with de-escalation is taking a break. Get out of the... Because when we're flooded with adrenaline, our brains... How many of you would agree with this? When I've been angry, I've made some of the poorest decisions in my life when I've been angry. Why is that? Yeah, we all do it. You cut off the higher functioning of your brain, right? Yeah.
So in a parent-child conflict, everybody's very upset.
Yeah.
And you send the child to the group. Is that stonewalling? Or is that defusing the situation?
That could be appropriate. You want to send them to the room to calm down. However, you want to follow up with a conversation with them. Mm-hmm. So right now you need to go to your room to calm down. and we'll talk when you calm down. So that's, yeah, you want to come back to it. Yeah, so you want to get, because they can't receive. That's the thing, you've just cut off the higher functioning of your brain. Actually, if you were to put your brain under a scan and look at the blood flow, it's gone up here. you're in the primitive part of your brain. You're
the
in the
heart,
fight or flight.
The heart is pounding so much. The heart is pounding. There.
They're not listening. They're not listening. So you need to first de-escalate. And sometimes we need to take a break as a parent. We need to de-escalate so we can put our brain into focus here and work on it. Yeah. So
you can come up with, like with my daughter and I had a code word when either one of us were at that breaking point. And that was something I learned in some ADD and ADHD. I would find seminars and I'd be in there with the teachers going to the seminars and don't tell us because I gotta figure this stuff out. You know, so much.
So there's a lot of de-escalation skills there. For little children, rather than screaming across the house, go to where they are and be authoritative and speak and get the thing, whatever situation solved, right? So, but that's part of the chaos. If I'm yelling across the room and everybody's yelling.
You just make a decision to stop yelling. I just decided stop, that one
stop
day,
yelling.
I'm just gonna stop
and
yelling.
Just, you know, and even if, bed, you, even if you laugh, what's going on? But calm down and just go and see. And I know parenting can be so frustrating, so hopefully these little tidbits will help you here. So getting them calm down, so getting them de-escalated is so important. I should put that in here. You want to get out of the fight or flight response in the brain, especially with the couples. When you're going at it, both of you need to take a break sometimes. But agree to come back together. Mm-hmm. Agree to have the conversation. We need to talk about this.
I know when we were first married, because yeah. I would get so upset and cry. And I had to write it out. I had to write Fritz these long letters. Poor guy. But it helped me get it out, and it helped me de-escalate, and it helped me to find my wording and my thoughts and what really was going on. And I remember one day going to go write a letter again, and the Lord's like, okay, Gretchen, it's time to learn how to talk.
Yeah, and those were helpful because then, rather than me getting defensive in the moment, I could think about it.
Yeah.
And allow the spirit to.
And there was times too with my younger daughter, because she was very quiet, very shy, very quiet. She and I literally would chat through the wall. Like, I'd be in my office, she'd be in her bedroom, and we would talk on the computer. Because that, for her, was safe. That was the way she needed to communicate with me. And I was just happy to be communicating, mm-hmm. So.
Yeah, yeah.
And I also, I know a lot of parents are like, I don't want to text, I don't want to hear texting, I want to have a conversation, I want you to call me. And I'm like, texting saved my life. Because as I'm texting, I'm slowing down. But if I was there verbally, too much would come out of my mouth. So texting was also a beautiful invention, at least for me.
Yeah. And it can be. It's very, texting can be difficult when there's emotions involved.
Texting can be, you don't argue in text, but you can communicate.
But you can communicate, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so moving on here. Kind of coming into home plate here. Ready to take the slide into home plate. The EAG process. So you got the RASA, you got the EAG process. EAG is, this is a great tool. Again, I've done, maybe we should set up a week-long seminar on this, but I wanted to put it out here because what I wanted to press home on this idea is to teach responsibility. The best thing that we can do, one of the things I hear, again, all the time, is this external locus of control. It's everybody else's fault. If so-and-so didn't do this, if the teacher would teach right, da, 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 on and on and on. It's an external, somebody else's problem. Going into life with that mindset is...
victim mentality.
Yeah, it's victim mentality, but I was just you want to build in the responsibility. So sending a child into life without them having the idea that I'm responsible for my actions, is setting them up for a real problem. This is very common in addictions counseling. It's always this denial. It's always everybody else's fault. And until the addict shifts his thinking and saying, this is my fault, even if there's trauma and pain that needs to be worked through, right now I'm responsible for the decisions I'm making and the choices that I'm about to make in the next day. One of the things I'm always telling the clients is that make, especially addictions, make the next right choice. What's the next right choice? What's the next best choice?
Little runner,
and keep making it, and as you continually make those right choices, life begins to change. So this is what we want to build into our kids, and you can do that by using the EA process. And basically, the EAG is the EIAG. Again, it's a great, great acronym. Experience. Something's happened. It's just simply an experience. I'm bored at school. Or no, let's see. Let me think about this. I got in an argument at school with so-and-so. Then that's the issue. Then you investigate. Well, I'm wondering, what did that do to you? Or how did you respond? Or what was going on for you? Well, So when you got angry, what were you thinking about? I wanted to get revenge. That's the investigating part. It's giving the opportunity for them to identify their emotions. This is huge. You want to build emotional intelligence into our kids. And then
this is good for you and for them, because the child now is learning how to verbalize their feelings. Mm-hmm. They're learning how to investigate their feelings, because we can be angry and pissed off, and we tend to throw everything into one big pile, but there's some specifics underneath. We're hurt, and why did that hurt come from? Instead of just stop being angry, you know, you need to be nice. There's hurt there, there's frustration.
Yeah, so rather than deny the emotions, identify them. Emotions are emotions. They're just the way we're wired. God's made us this way. Emotions are emotions, so identify them. And then what are some better ways to respond? Then
if we jump to emotions as sin, we're missing it. Just investigate.
It's my response and how I manage those emotions that are problematic, right? So once you've done that, then you can analyze, well, what do you think? Could you have done anything different? Or is there anything you can do now? You're helping them problem solve. You're teaching them problem solving skills. And then generalize. If this happens again, what could you do next time? You're teaching them life skills. Problem solving skills, life skills. Because they're going to, any of us who ever work for other people, you're going to come across people in your workplace that drive you crazy.
It's really good to, take work for instance. Say, all right, I'm going to go to work today. I'm going to try EAG at the water cooler. I'm going to try EAG with the girl I work with. And practice it when it's not so close to home, when it's your husband or your kid or you're really upset. Practice this EAG with someone at church. I mean, these are things that need to rewire in your brain, and I'm a really big one too for hanging signs around the house to help me. If I really want to step out of high judgment, or if I really want to step into being kind, and when we've had trauma, we've had any situation, we're so hardwired for protecting ourselves that we're on the defensive, we're protecting, and to literally, for me to have to learn how to step into kindness and empathy, I had to practice it. I had to isolate it, I had to see it, I had to recognize it, and I had to practice it. And then the dividends of that, before an event, all right, Gretchen, you're gonna show up, you're gonna look through the room, I had to deal with my social anxiety, I had to learn, if someone's gonna ask me a couple of questions, then I need to ask them a question. And I had to practice these things because I just was...
It takes practice.
It takes practice.
So thinking about this, you can use this at work. As a matter of fact, if you're a manager or supervisor of some kind, think about this. What's going on? What's the problem? What's the result of that problem? Right? What do you think we need to do about it? You can use the same kind of process. Your best managers and supervisors are the ones who do this. The ones, I guarantee you, the ones you dislike the most are the ones who are constantly telling you what to do and not listening about what the problem is. When I was a manager, in fact, I was operations manager for a 50-employee company, when there was a problem, I went out on the line, and the guy on the machine, because I used to work on a machine, and it was usually he was the one who knew how to fix it. and those guys on the floor made me look good as a boss, right? So that's what you're doing, is you're teaching skills to your kids. So again, that book, Teaching Self-Reliant Children in a Self-Indulgent World, goes into depth on this process. Some people are natural at this. Other people who, like my wife, tend to be more fixers, this is harder. And again, it's a way to engage in conversation. So, in honoring our time, and you guys have kids, I have a few minutes here. Counseling. Again, I gave my cards are up here, and get some brochures if you have some counseling needs, or if you're just considering, do I need counseling or coaching, what's the difference? Happy to talk to you about that. We have Daniel available too. Coaching, we do some programs in coaching. I also do some executive coaching. I've worked with pastors and pastors and their wives. I've worked with business leaders, ministry leaders, in helping them be more successful in what they're doing and looking at limiting behaviors and thinking. So I love coaching. It's just another, I do a lot of counseling all week long. The coaching helps me shift into a different mindset. So that's it. I'm keeping to my commitment at ending at noon. Thank you so much for coming. I enjoy teaching. I enjoy encouraging people. So we're here. If you have some questions, I don't mind you coming up and bending my ear for a little bit, or Gretchen or Daniel, we're here for you. But officially, we're done. And I hope this is